And we should be live. Hello, everyone. For those of you who are watching the video and folks who are coming in with the live stream, welcome to the inaugural first episode of the Tolkeen War campaign with the Coalition side. So I will be the GM, Inferno Canuck. And if it's okay by the fellow players here, I'm thinking of introducing you one by one. Just let us know who you are, and if you like, if you're comfortable with, give like a brief description of your character. It could be as simple as your class and your name, or if you have something about background or physical details that you'd really like to share, let me know. And I was just informed by chat that I didn't change the title for this stream, so give me 2 seconds or people are going to think this is Bendy and the Ink Machine and they're going to be very upset. So let's get the ball. While I'm doing that, let's get the ball rolling. And Chance, are you okay starting us off?
Sure, let's do it.
All right,
so
please do.
My character's name, yeah, absolutely, my character's name is Chance Matheson. Looks like I spelled it wrong. I'm gonna change it to Masterson.
Okay.
Character sheet says Matheson, but I like Masterson better. Anyways, oh, my player's name is Tom, so my name is Tom. Character's name is Chance Matheson. He's a city rat from the burbs of Chi-Town. Worked his way up through with a prison job and then eventually an actual job, and now he just runs random jobs. Same.
Okay. Nice, nice. Very, very cool. All right. And next we will go with let me double check here. Jordan.
My name's Jordan. My character is Corporal Matthew Band-Aid Miller, a good boy from Ironheart who, unfortunately, at a young age, has developed a limp in his right left leg, I think, pretty sure. See, now I'm going to embarrass myself. I'm not remembering stuff.
That's okay. Don't be embarrassed. I'm literally changing. People can see me do what I'm doing on my dashboard right now in the stream. That's more embarrassing than that.
Professional, Inferno. Professional.
I'm professional.
He's just a good old boy, willing to and ready to do his part for the Coalition.
Awesome. Awesome. Excellent. All right. Next we'll have me, Inferno. No, just kidding. Next we'll have Jason, if you're good to go. All
right, I'm Jason. I'm playing Corporal Evan Lucas. Mm-hmm. I was a farm boy on the edge of CS territory when a demon attacked my town, and I was saved by CS soldiers. After that, I looked up to the CS, and I enlisted as soon as I can, becoming a ranger for them.
Oh, awesome. Very cool. All right, Scarlet Ranger.
Hey.
Hey.
People can just call me Scarlet.
Okay,
I am
Scarlet.
Playing Slicks, CS Rat Mutant, meaning I was born and raised in Lone Star, and pretty much forced to do whatever the CS wants. There you go.
There you go. Easy peasy. And Senno.
All right. I am Senno/Sano/ whatever the fuck you want to call me. I am playing Victoria Siri, a rogue scholar working as a merc from the Coalition. She is from the Northern Gun Manistique Imperium area, and she'll serve as a radio operator, historian, tactician, maybe if they let them, and that general thing.
Cool, cool. All right, and last but certainly not least, Trav.
Hello, I am Trav. I am playing Luther Hunter. He's Justice Ranger called up from Lone Star. Just gonna help in the Tolkeen campaign.
All right. Awesome. So, just make sure I have all the characters, because I have my notes open here, right? So we have Victoria, Corporal Matthew Band-Aid Miller, Tex, Corporal Evan Lucas, Slicks, and Chance So did you decide to say Masterson instead of is it Chance Masterson?
Yeah, I want to go with Masterson.
Masterson. Okay. Awesome. Awesome. Wonderful. Great. So, with that, I'm just wondering if there's any last little bookkeeping, anything like that going. Oh, yes, I do remember. There is another disclaimer for everyone as well. I'm very familiar with the RIFTS system, but I'm an old school. I guess I still am. I'm a bit of an old school RIFTS GM using the original rule set. I decided this new campaign is a great opportunity for me to update my rules to the RIFTS ultimate rules. The core of the game is essentially the same. You know, roll a 1d20 for combat, add modifiers. Roll a 1d100 for skills. You know, low is good, add modifiers. That's all the same, right? Saving throws, the whole deal, right? There's some small differences, especially when it comes to combat. So when we reach combat in this mini campaign, if we reach it, no, we'll probably reach it, I'll just appreciate a little bit of patience because there's still some concepts like the new to hit rules and whatnot that I'm not 100% familiar with yet. Do we have anyone here in the chat or any of you players? Are you guys experienced with Rift's Ultimate Edition?
I know a bit myself.
Okay, awesome.
Yeah, I know a bit.
Sure. I mean, I'm the GM, so I'll do the call, right? But if I make a mistake, please feel free to point it out so I can continue to learn and develop with the new Rift's Ultimate system. So don't worry about that. I don't mind at all. Okay. So with one last thing I need to do, which is... I'm very appreciative of new subscribers. I'm very appreciative of the bits that people are going to be donating, but that might be a little distracting during the stream itself. So I'm just going to mute the sound in regards to that. So just let me go ahead and do that. And I'm doing this with a new window now so people don't see, you know, my personal information.
I think I was going to hack your bank account.
You can't show how the sausage is made. Is made.
You really can't. My sausage. No one gets sausage.
Damn it.
Uh-oh. Inferno underscore. Uh-oh. Do I not know my password? Oh, no! No, I had to do a captcha because I failed it too many times. Shit. All right, let me open up a new window and see. Let's see if they can see it. Okay, no, they can't. All right, good. Very good. Da-da-da-da-da-da. Oh, that's not nice. Alright. Sorry, small little technical difficulties. Here we are. Alright, let's just turn off the alert sounds. And we are good to go. Alright. Let me set the stage. It is a cool twilight just outside Coalition Forward Base Echo, a bustling forward base in the modern-day Wisconsin area, just 150 miles southeast of the great free city of Tolkeen itself. The base itself was hastily built over the past 6 months, and at this current point in time, it has all the modern medical, training, and obviously barracks facilities as necessary for a significant military base. The Coalition presence here in the region, of course, has caused great alarm and concern, and day by day, more and more troops, more and more mercenaries, and more personnel are funneled through this particular point. But we don't start this campaign right in the middle of Forward Camp Echo. Instead, we move the scene 3 miles to the east in a small clearing with a small rocky outcropping jutting up from the ground, a natural inclination of stone. At this stone inclination, the 6 individuals that were just introduced to you there, at separate times over the past week, have been informed quite firmly to meet at this particular date and time. They're also informed not to tell another single soul in regards to it, and to await further instruction. As you gather, of course, you find that you yourselves are not alone, and you will soon be joined by someone else, an NPC. In the meantime, however, I want to give you players a perfect opportunity to roleplay if you wish to. Your first interactions, sizing each other up, etc. Is that something you guys would be interested in doing?
I'm down.
Sure.
All right. So if you need any sort of guided instruction or anything like that, if not, I'll sit back for a moment and wait for an opportunity to bring in our our taskmaster, so to speak.
I would just say that Chance would be the really handsome fellow.
Okay.
A very fine black suit.
Mm-hmm.
And some black loafers.
Okay.
Just watching everybody.
All right.
Victoria would still be kind of near her big boss ATV.
Mm-hmm.
That she drove up there.
Mm-hmm.
She's currently wearing what looks to be a hoodie with a rifle slung on her back.
Mm-hmm.
And a vibro knife on her hip.
Mm-hmm.
And she's just observing people, kind of hiding behind the ATV.
Okay. We like to call it a tactical positioning, but fair enough.
Yep, tactical positioning. They might be all traitors, who knows?
You never know.
Mm-hmm. Matthew would be in his normal CS uniform,
mm-hmm.
C18 on his hip, and slightly in tune towards Evan.
Okay.
Yeah. Evan will be staying there. He looks like he's wearing standard camouflage wilderness clothes, also mm-hmm. a bit dirty. He probably hiked here instead of taking a car.
Okay, interesting.
He has a heavily personalized C10 on his slung to his back, and he's just standing there, leaning against a tree, okay. looking at everyone.
Nice.
Well, Slix will be there. He is wearing dark sunglasses. He's wearing a black leather jacket. He's just standing around, observing everyone, taking notes of who's there. Some familiar faces, some not. Just taking notes.
Luther is just sitting by his hover cycle that he drove up. He's wearing his riding armor, has a couple rifles strapped to his back, pistol in each hip, just standing around waiting for whoever's going to show up.
All right. Am I good to continue?
I think so.
Okay. All right. Did I miss anyone? Were there descriptions? We got Chance, Victoria, Evan Lucas, Luther. We're good. Okay, good. Yeah. Good. The silence that lies, thick in the air of each of you kind of warily or carefully observing each other is broken by the sound of an engine. A coalition black, deep, deep black, armored personnel carrier rolls up its way from the direction in the base as well, kicking up dirt as it does so. A mere 75 feet away from you, it stops, and the side entrance hatch is opened. With that, steps out a tall woman, approximately 5 feet 11 inches, dressed in crisp and clean officer's uniform. In fact, she hovers by the entrance, the side entrance of the APC as she waits for the dust itself to settle to the ground before she takes a perfectly polished boot and sets herself on the ground confidently. She approaches you with her chin held up high, her shoulders back, an individual of great poise and composure. Some of you, I'll leave it up to whom, may have recognized this woman along the forward military base Echo. She is known as Captain Long, Captain Joyce Long, and she has a bit of a small history behind her, and the fact that she is one of the only captains who does not actively command over a military unit. She is truly independent, and her prerogatives, her orders, are not as clear as some others in the coalition military. Step after perfect step, she finishes walking and stands nearby the stony outcropping in which you are all somewhat semi-circular positioned around. As she does so, she looks at each and every single one of you with a careful, dark eye, moving first to Luther, then to Evan, then to Slicks, in which she gives a small sniff of her nose, perhaps the whisper of a sneer, Captain Matthew Miller, Victoria Siri, and finally, Chance Masterson himself. As she looks over you with a cool, observational eye, she says nothing, and with the exception of that small sniff towards Snicks, her composure remains the same. A stern, gaunt-faced woman. Until finally, in the very twilight, light evening air, she says, "Good. You have all gathered as I have requested. I have also heard no reports of this meeting, so I can only assume that your desire for secrecy and tact is fulfilled. I, for those of you who do not know, am Captain Joyce Long, and it is to you that I wish to impart an extremely important and sensitive mission. For those of you who have no interest in truly helping the Coalition, or for those of you who do not desire great personal and material rewards, as well as a pride of a job well done, can get into your vehicles and head back to the camp and report to your regular duties." She pauses for a moment as she looks around, surveying, to see if anyone moves or vacates the area.
All Evan does is, Evan stands up straight and gives a salute.
Nice. Sorry, what else?
Smile. Very charming, beautiful smile.
Good.
Luther just nods at her as she looks at him.
Okay.
Matt also pops a salute.
Excellent. She gives her own return salute for those who salute towards her. A simple, at-ease gesture. And she gives the slightest hint at a smile towards the roguish gentleman who beams so brightly towards her. As she says, "Good. Because this is not an official coalition-sanctioned mission. That is not to say you will not be assisting your kin or the Emperor. It's just that it is so sensitive that we cannot have much or any sort of paper trail. You will be tasked to infiltrate Tolkeen itself. For some of you," as she looks towards Slicks, "you have been selected due to your physical capabilities to blend in, and perhaps pulling on the softer heartstrings of the citizens of Tolkeen. The rest of you have been selected due to your significant skills and, I believe, the potential for upward mobility within your careers. Others, perhaps, simply see a point where opportunity meets necessity. Regardless, once you arrive in Tolkeen, you will meet with an agent, an affiliate of ours, named Sarkin. You will meet him at a small little dance hall and bar named the Confident Heart. You are to arrive there in exactly 2 days' time at 1:00 p.m., 1300 hours. When you get to the Confident Heart, only one of you is to take the far corner booth in the northeast section and wait for contact. The rest of you are to observe the Confident Heart and ensure the individual you send inside is not compromised by any counterintelligence individuals. Once Sarkin meets with you, he will give you the details of your mission, specifically the item in which you are to destroy or preferably compensate and return to my possession. I cannot give you details now on the object, but suffice to say it will be integral and absolutely necessary that Tolkeen does not have this item in possession, this magical item in possession, when we start our military operations in earnest. Do I need to repeat myself, or are there any follow-up questions?
No, ma'am.
Just the shake of the head.
No, ma'am.
I'll smile. I still got that smile going, but I'll give a slight nod.
Okay. A nod in understanding, I take it. Not a nod as in, yes, I have follow-up questions, ma'am.
No, not a nod of understanding, yes.
Okay, cool.
I'm all right, ma'am.
Okay. She, for the first time, gives an actual, genuine, and relieved smile. She says, "It is good to know that I only need to say once with you, and you are showing your professionalism. One final thing. We absolutely, positively, cannot have you go in Tolkeen with any sort of governmental coalition weapons or gear. That would be far too suspicious. For those of you who might have your personal arms, armor, and whatnot, you may use them, and if they are damaged, you can return them to the base after your mission is complete, and we will repair, maintain, and fix whatever is necessary free of charge. For those of you who only have coalition-sanctioned gear, come back to the..." Oh, give me a moment. Breaking out of character. Help me out with the military term. The quartermaster, right? He's the one. The quartermaster is the person.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you. Before you depart tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock in the morning, 0800 hours, report to the quartermaster before he starts his day and ask for Captain Long's requisitions. There you can select some items of weapons and armor that have been used by local mercenaries and independent individuals in the area. Gear that will not raise your profile or any suspicion. Is that understood?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Understood, ma'am.
Just nods.
Excellent. Then I suggest you rest up. You'll have yourselves a very trying challenge ahead. And with that, she once again confidently and briskly moves herself towards the armored personnel carrier, enters through the side hatch closes, and after a few moments, the engine kicks back into gear, and the vehicle rumbles off into a distance. Before we move to equipping yourselves in the morning and getting the adventure underway, all of you right now are still kind of standing together, kind of forced to work together in regards to this mission. I'll give you as much time as you need to talk amongst yourselves before I move ahead to the next scene. And if you guys have any questions, please feel free to ask me.
So Chance will look around at everybody, and remembering that he paid a driver to drop him off and that he doesn't have a ride back in, he'll confidently say, so who's giving me a ride back?
Well, bud, you don't need a ride back if you know the wilderness. You're free to hike with me. Nice to see this guy.
My loafers.
My loafers.
You're free to do so with me.
I'm going to extend a hand, Chance Masterson. It's nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you, Victoria. She goes out and shakes it.
Still there?
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Excellent. Well, if you guys like... Oh, no, she's not 54 and a half feet tall, Evan. I see you measuring. It is not to scale. Anyway, she is not to scale, and she's not even here. All right. Well, shall we just get the quartermaster, the equipping out of the way so you guys can actually hit the trail itself?
Yep.
Excellent, excellent, excellent. So, first and foremost, just completely out of character, those of you, I do have all your character sheets open and all that good stuff, right? So, there might be a few of you who needs to, much of your gear, like, for example, Corporal Miller there, the vibro knife is no problem, the scalpel's no problem, the laser pistol, you might need another laser pistol, you know what I mean?
Yep.
Etc. Etc. So, shall we just go from character to character, and just make sure your equipment is offer some switch out equipment so you guys aren't going in to a hostile situation naked and without any sort of weaponry.
Yeah, that'd probably be good.
Okay,
that'd be great.
Great. So we'll pound this out real quick. So I'll start with Victoria here. Looking at your gear, I see you have a C10 light assault laser rifle.
Yeah. Okay. That'd be the only thing I'd worry about.
Because you have the Urban Warrior armor, so no big deal, right? So give me 2 seconds and open up my list. Now this is I would offer this list for all of you to see, but honestly it is pages and pages and pages and big, so I think it might be easier for me just to give you a couple options and you guys just choose what you want. Very similar to what a quartermaster would do. Is that A-okay?
That's fine.
Okay, great. Let me just go to my MDC weapon listing.
I'm pretty sure that Chance doesn't have anything that's coalition, so okay. Chance will just like go to wherever he's staying, pack up some clothes and some personal items.
Okay, awesome, awesome. All right, so the C10 light assault does 2d6. So let me see if I can't find something comparable for you. A neural mace. No, just kidding.
How do I shoot this?
I don't know. How about NGL5 Northern Gun Laser Rifle? Does 3d6 MDC? 1600
sure.
feet? Okay. The other alternative, because I like to give I love to give people choices, you know what I mean, is there's an independent firearm as well. The L20 pulse rifle, it does 2d6 per single shot or a 66 multiple pulse burst. It's also 1600 feet. So would you prefer the Northern Gun or the
L20? L20 actually has
okay.
a pretty good rifle.
Great. So I'm going to just copy and paste this and put it in Discord so you can write it on your own character.
I got the stats, actually.
You have the stats? Well, look at you go, Mr. Prepared. I am impressed.
I have a physical copy of the book right here.
Hey, physical copy for the win. All right. Yep. So next I have here on the next character sheet, I think this is Tex. Yeah, it is Tex. All right. Is there any gear that we got to just adjust for you?
I'm pretty sure most of my stuff isn't really coalition affiliated.
Yeah, let's see, NG. Yeah, that's a Northern Gun, so that's no problem. We just don't want you guys to scream, "I work for the coalition states," as you enter into Tolkeen itself. Hover cycles, no problem. I'm just trying to find your armor on your character sheet. Where is it again?
It's in the miscellaneous notes area by the power armor.
Oh, okie dokie.
I didn't know where else to put it.
No, that's okay. No, that works. Riding armor. The Maverick, right?
I have the riding armor, mm-hmm. and then I also have the Vaqueros environmental heavy body armor.
Okay, so you can pick one of those.
I'll probably take the heavy one.
Okay, perfect, perfect. Okay, Slex, we already said you're A-OK. Okay, Evan Lucas, what do we have here? Oh, you
have the CA-30.
Okay, so I'll give you the same choice. You can go with the L-20 or the Northern Gun rifle.
L-20.
Okay, do you need the stats? Would you like me to copy and paste them for you?
I got it.
Look at you go. I'm so proud of you guys.
Also, I'm not sure that Slicks was good. It was Chance that was good.
Oh, it was
right?
Chance that was good. I'm sorry,
yeah,
Slicks.
All my gear is CS.
Also, I have CA-3 light dead boy armor.
Okay, yeah, we need to. Okay, sorry, I'll finish off with Lucas here, Evan Lucas, and then I'll get to you, Slicks. I'm sorry, it was Chance who was okay. I didn't mean to forget about you, Mutant Ratty.
It's fine. It just would have been awkward.
All right. So is 80MDC. Okay. Let me open up my other list here. My body armor list. Coalition. No, we don't want that. You can choose the gladiator armor, which is also pretty mobile, or you can go with the Bushman, or you can go with the Explorer.
I'll take the Gladiator.
The Gladiator? Okay.
Yep.
You need the stats? I can copy and paste them for you.
Nah. Okay. I'm good.
All right, great. Okay, so we're good with you. All right, Slicks. Oh, my goodness, yeah. You definitely need... Okay, so you have the C-12 assault laser rifle. So, yep. Same thing, Northern Gun or the L-20.
Can I have the stats for the Northern Gun one?
I'll be happy to. Give me 2 seconds here. Let me copy-paste for you. Welcome to Epic Copy-Pasting Goodness, everyone. All right, Northern Gun... laser rifle. Boop. I'm putting them in disco right now. I am top professional, you're right. Don't do this at home, children. Alright.
Dangerous.
Boom. Yeah, it is. It's extremely dangerous. Don't copy and paste at home. Thank you, Tim, by the way. Alright, Slicks. Still there?
Still there?
Yep, still here.
Okay, sweet, okay, sweet. So you're going to go with the Northern Gun one?
I am going to go with the Northern Gun one.
Okay, now you need a pistol, right?
Yep.
So you can go with a Northern Gun laser pistol. It's pretty simple. These both do kind of just 1DC, MDC. But you could also go with a Wilks laser pistol as well, which also does 1d6, but it has a bonus to strike, a +2 bonus on aimed shots because of its lightweight and superior balance.
All right, that sounds it. Let's get the Wilks.
Wilks, okay. Let me copy-paste for you. And don't worry, this is just temporary gear to blend in. You might pick up other gear along the way, so don't be too sad that your stuff is too hot for Tolkeen. Too spicy. Okay, and your armor is light riot armor.
Yep, that's coalition.
Yeah, that's very coalition. Although, okay, so you have an option. Because you may or may not have been chosen because you're a mutant rat and that can deal with, you know, DB scum a little bit easier.
Yep, I was thinking I could either be going as a DB or a runaway mutant rat.
Exactly.
My only problem with that is they're probably going to check for an ID chip.
Well, you have an option. The quartermaster is willing to just give you new armor and you can just go as whoever you want, or he can temporarily remove your ID chip and replace it when you return.
I will remove the ID chip.
Okay. It is a very quick and somewhat painful procedure. He doesn't use enough local anesthetic because you're not too sure exactly why. You don't take any sort of long-term damage or whatnot, but it takes about 20 minutes or so for him to cut it out of you and remove it, and goes from there. So you are technically, right now, not registered, but you have 5 loyal coalition individuals working with you, so... he kind of gives a veiled threat, the quartermaster, who's like this gruff 50-something balding man with a like a light gray mustache, like thin atop of his lips. He kind of gives a snarl, and he kind of implies that, you know, don't get too used to this.
All right, he just nods.
Okay. And with that, so you being as a runaway, having, you know, armor is no big deal. Chance was good, so our last individual is Matthew Miller. And hey. I think we just have, well, we have the heavy body armor and the laser pistol, right?
Yeah.
So, very similar in regards to the laser pistol. You can go with the Wilks or the Northern Gun. The Northern Gun is a little bit hardier. The Wilks is a little bit more sleeker, slender, and more accurate. They both do the same damage.
Hey, we'll go for the Wilks, then.
Wilks, okay. And I believe that's still copy-pasted in the Discord, yes?
Yep.
Okay. Excellent. And then just your body armor as well, yes?
Yeah.
So, similarly to... Evan Lucas. That's right. You have the choice between the Gladiator, the Bushman, or the Explorer.
Gladiator, I guess.
Okay. They all have pretty much the same MDC. It's kind of more just the style of it.
Right.
Okay. I'm going to copy and paste it here for you, just in case. And you guys are all geared up. Now, your personal vehicles. Do any of your personal vehicles scream, I work for the Coalition? Or are they pretty much your generic types? I know I heard a Big Boss ATV, and I know some folks have a hover cycle. Some people are hoofing it.
Feet is the best vehicle.
Mm-hmm. I'd say mine is all right.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Well, there's no point over complicating things. In addition, we can always just ensure that. Oh my goodness! I didn't even notice these plus signs. Chance and Slicks, did you just put these up, or was I talking over you this entire time?
It's fine. Very answered.
Yeah, it's good.
Okay. Oh, okay. All right. I'll keep better close. Sorry, I'm like navigating like 5 different screens while we're doing this. So my apologies if I miss you. My deepest apologies. Oh, really, Victoria? Well, that's too bad. This is gonna make infiltration difficult.
Yeah.
So, is it fair to say that all of you do, after meeting the quartermaster, do meet outside Ford Camp Echo at 0800 hours at 8 o'clock in the morning?
Yep.
Okay. Yep.
Might be there a little bit early, but yeah.
Okay. All right. Cool. Now.
This would have his clothes change. He'd no longer be wearing the suit. Looking at like cargo pants and a black t-shirt.
Okay.
With some logo on it. It looks like a pile of sticks, so you can't really read it anyways.
Okay. A pile of sticks. That sounds about right.
Yeah, like a death metal band, you know, uh-huh. the logos that look like just like a pile of branches.
Oh my god. Okay. Awesome.
And then and then you can clearly see he's got like cop holsters under the mm-hmm. jacket. Mm-hmm. He's got his 45 there, 45 mm. semi-automatic, and then on his hip, almost Han Solo style, he's got his Northern Gun ion blaster.
Slick. And I'm not talking about the mutant
backpack. Backpack, sunglasses, mm-hmm. smoking a cigarette, ready to go.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, I'll leave it up to you guys. You have kind of two options, all right? You guys can, you know, put your heads together and kind of figure out a proper way to approach Tolkeen and what your cover is going to be when you get there, right? Or we can kind of streamline this a little bit, and I can do some skill checks, kind of help you navigate the terrain over towards Tolkeen, you know, describe the journey along the way and any hiccups and that sort of thing. I guess the big question is are you the type of groups or the type of players who kind of want to talk things out? Or do you guys want to just be like, okay, GM, just let us know, you know, what to roll and you know, paint the story for us? What would you guys prefer?
I'm fine with talking things out.
Okay.
I'm talking.
All right. So,
I'm going to go with the group kind of guy.
Sure. So let me give you a little bit of background knowledge to kind of help with the talking things out, all right? You guys do know that Tolkeen isn't on absolute high alert, but due to the military buildup, there's also a military buildup on Tolkien's side as well. They are hiring mercenaries like crazy, mostly due to a referral system, okay? So if you could, as one suggestion, if you could get a referral, you could easily infiltrate or get in Tolkeen as mercenaries. In addition, the security has been heightened considerably as well, and Tolkeen, the free city of Tolkeen, has started to turn people away at the gates if they raise a little too much suspicion or something doesn't seem right. But it's also very simple to kind of infiltrate the areas. Infiltrate the security itself. It is not impregnable by any means, right? In addition, there are rumors that the black market, a criminal syndicate, is slowly trying to regain a foothold back into Tolkeen as well. And there may be an opportunity to temporarily ally yourselves with these criminals, these absolute scumbag criminals, in order to deal with a larger foe. That's as far as, those are just kind of general rumors amongst the base, perhaps information that you yourselves may have ferreted out. You know, I'll kind of leave it up to your own, you know, character agency, right? Now, the big question is how to get there, of course. The most direct route is straight from the base to Tolkeen itself, right? But it does run a chance. You would get there far ahead of time. It's only really half a day's travel, perhaps even more. So you'd be able to get to Tolkeen very, very early, you know what I mean? Long after, because you have 2 days in which to get into Tolkeen and meet with this Sarkin fellow, right? So it's the most direct route, but it's also the most obvious route, too. And if anyone kind of sees you, any fellow travelers or whatever, if anyone kind of sees you heading that direction, they might kind of put two and two together. So you may, as a group, choose to take a slightly longer but less suspicious route. You can circle along the west of Tolkeen, go up by Solomon, way, way up north of Solomon, and then head back down from the north, and that will take a day and a half travel. That is by far the least suspicious, but you'll have the least amount of time in which to infiltrate Tolkeen. All right? The other way is to go along the east of Tolkeen and just kind of do a small hook through a wilderness area where it's really easy to kind of lose folks and come in from the east. And that's kind of a medium route, right? You can get to Tolkeen in about a day, right? So shortest route, most direct, half a day, no problem. Medium route is going from the east, that takes one day. And the Solomon route, the northern route, the least suspicious takes a day and a half. Did I info bomb you guys too much, or are you guys cool?
No, I'm good. Okay, cool.
So I'll let you guys make all these decisions. Now that I kind of laid some info, and if you have any questions for me, what your characters might know, etc., please feel free to ask them.
Would that the Solomon route pretty much get us to Tolkeen like the morning of?
Yeah. Maybe, but early in the morning of, like 3 a.m.
Okay. Okay.
All right. It's 3 a.m. Hmm. Those kind of fishy travelers come in at 3 a.m.
Well, we could always take our time with it and get there at whatever time we want.
That's true. Yeah, you don't have to be there at the gates at 3 a.m., right? You could wait a couple hours out, wait for dawn to break, and then, you know, arrive.
That still leaves us less time, though. So
yes, that is true.
Tavern will bring up, well, you folks, I'm a bit of a wilderness person myself, so I say we go east, right? We cut through the forest a little. I'm pretty sure I can help us navigate our way through it. It's maybe not the most safe, but it's better than wasting another half a day.
I can agree with this.
Yeah, it's probably a better idea.
Alrighty, then.
Excellent. And, you know what, I'll let you guys worry on the journey, or discuss during the journey, on exactly how you might want to infiltrate or get into Tolkeen itself. Regardless, if you guys are ready, I can start you all on the journey to Tolkeen. A quick note about personal vehicles. Obviously, it'll be much more expedient for everyone to be in or on some sort of vehicle. We have, so let's just do a quick checklist of the vehicles that we do have. So if you have a vehicle and are going to be using it, speak now.
Bonjour.
I will.
Yes.
Oh, yes, yeah, sorry. I should also say, say if you have one and what it is.
Big Boss ATV.
Okay, that's good.
Hoversack.
Okay.
NG480 hovercycle.
Okay. So, but that's okay, because the Big Boss ATV can fit four people, right?
Yep, pilot and three passengers.
Great. So, the people who don't have a vehicle, by the sounds of it, is Slick.
Chance. Evan,
pardon me?
Yeah. Saying that Chance doesn't have a vehicle.
Chance doesn't. And Victoria does. Yeah. Who else does?
Me, Slickson. Evan, Slickson, Chance.
Okay, it is Evan. Okay, Evan, Slickson, Chance. Cool. You guys could load on into the ATV. I'm assuming that's okay with the ATV owner?
Yeah, I'm cool with that.
Okay, cool.
Shotgun.
Shotgun.
I already called shotgun.
Should we can't just shove them on the back?
Pretty sure you can't. Okay.
Thank God I don't have to deal with that.
So now, as we start the journey, we're going to do a little pre-rolling, right? So it's not so obvious, but this could really play into parts. So for those of you, we'll do one at a time. For those of you who have land navigation, right, and detect ambush, go ahead and roll them. It's going to be your standard skill level. No bonuses, no penalties, or anything like that. Okay? Let me know if you succeed or fail. And I'm going to open up my little notebook to also take note.
I succeed by 16 on my land nav.
Excellent.
Fail by 11 on land nav.
Okay, so... Okay, oh, sorry, give me 2 seconds. I gotta open up a free page. Oh my goodness. It's old notes.
Inferno, can I use Roadwise to maybe find a better route?
I was just... You know what? That is great. I was gonna have people do the standard things, and then any additional skills I might have missed, we would as well. So hold up, let me just record everyone's land navigation, detect ambush, and then we'll do these miscellaneous ones too. Is that cool?
Sure.
Okay, groovy. But yeah, no, that 100% pertains to it. All right, so Evan Lucas, Penn, there we go. Lucas, Evan. So you succeeded.
Yep.
Land nav. And you didn't have detect ambush, right?
Nope, I don't think anyone here has detect ambush.
Oh, I do.
Someone does, yeah.
I have it.
Yeah, okay.
I'm just waiting to roll it for Inferno to write everything down.
Thank you. I appreciate that. So Slicks, that was your land navigation and it was a fail?
Yep, but okay. I love
him. No big deal. All right, Luther.
And I failed by 4.
Okay, that was a fail, but by 4, okay. And Slicks, you failed by 11, okay. All right, I'm caught up now.
Hold on, let me just figure this
out. Sure, take your time. In the meantime, I'm going to entertain myself by reading the delightful chat. Oh, there we go.
Fill up by 5.
Okay, so that was your detect the ambush?
Yes.
Okay. All right, anyone else have land navigation or detect the ambush? Okay, I will take the silences. No, that's okay. So, who had the roadway skill?
Chance does. I'll go ahead and roll that now.
Okay.
17.
You succeeded by 17, yeah?
Oh, failed by 17, right? Oh. If I rolled a 58 and the skill's
41.
Oh,
you rolled a 58. Yeah. Okay. I'm reading that wrong. Okay. Yeah, fail by 17. Okay, that's all right. All right, now, this is just navigating both the wilderness, open plains, roadways, checking for danger, anything like that. Take a look at your character sheet and see if there's anything else that you might think pertain or kind of give you an advantage. If you can find something, great, pitch it to me. If not,
yeah. What about watching for anyone following us?
Sorry, what was
the skill?
Or
is that more surveillance? I have a tailing.
Ooh, tailing is more for surveillance. Yeah. But you know what? Once you get in the urban environment, you can also use that tailing skill to see if anyone's tailing you. But in an open wilderness area, I don't really... That seems like more of an urban skill.
What about surveillance?
Surveillance. You would need a necessarily subject in which to survey. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's more bugs and spy equipment from what I'm looking at.
Yeah.
If I remember right, it gives you a... I thought it gave you a bonus to, like, detecting if someone was following you.
Okay, you know what? All right.
Yeah, I'll check the skill description.
Oh, sure. Okay, check the skill description real quick. In the meantime, I'll hit Slicks there, who has the plus high.
Hey, would it be possible for me to identify sense by smell?
Oh.
Like for any weird stuff?
Definitely. Now, since you'll be inside the ATV for much of the journey, I mean, I guess if you roll the window down, it'd be no problem. Otherwise, I would have that skill pertain once your snout is in open air. But yeah, roll it.
Victoria, would you mind if I had the window rolled down?
Sure.
Just throw them on top to sniff. All right.
Fail by 7.
Oh, that's okay, Slicks.
I have wilderness survival. Is that pertaining at all?
No. This isn't having about hunting or foraging or making a shelter. This is just getting from point A to B safely and directly. And yeah, well, and not only are you getting the failures out now, but remember, at least with my campaigns, I keep a track of how much you succeed or fail by. So right now, you guys have very low thresholds, 4, 5, 7, 11. The biggest right now is 17. So don't think I'm going to make you fall on like 100 mines now and kill you all like an asshole. All right. How are we doing with the surveillance skill, my friend?
Yeah, looks like that is just for, like, watching. Not okay. so much. It gives you a bonus to, like, tailing somebody, mm-hmm. but...
Okay. Well, it was worth a shot. No big deal. No harm. No, can't, you know, nothing ventured, nothing gained. All right. I think we have all the predetermined skill checks out of our way. Are we good to get rolling, so to speak, and get hovering?
Yep.
Awesome. Awesome. So you hit the trail heading towards the northwest. Yes. Sorry, I'm trying to do the map in my head. Heading towards the northwest, towards a very dense section of vegetation and forest. The first few hours of the journey itself are relatively uneventful. The sky is overcast, and with the exception of a few troop columns, coalition troop columns, and some radio chatter with some local mercenaries, nothing of great event or purport hits you. It is when you begin to reach the actual forest area itself, Evan Lucas there, you're able to identify the perfect speed in which both hover cycles and the Big Boss ADV should maintain in order to have an exact balance between stealth and mobility, right? You don't want to be flooring it because you might run into something or go crashing in the woods. You also don't want to go at a crawl because, you know, time is of the essence. So thanks to your land navigation skills, Evan Lucas, you are able to advise individuals in the Big Boss ATV and, of course, in the hover cycles as well, kind of an optimum speed. If you want to roleplay that, go ahead. If not, we can just narratively talk about it.
Just narrative that, because okay, I don't know how to go with
that. No, that's no big deal. It's no big deal. So the big question is with the speed and mobility suggestions by Evan Lucas, would those of you piloting your own vehicles, you know, take that into advice?
I would.
Reluctantly.
Seems like he knows what he's doing.
Good. Let me move you on over. Boop. For no reason at all. Nope. It's just a picture of the woods. Yep, just a picture
of the woods.
It's very pretty. It's very pretty. It is actually very pretty. You... nope. No. Nope. Whatsoever. Nope. None. So,
just looking through it.
Oh, God damn it! This is what happens when I stream these. That's okay. It was telegraphed pretty clearly. It's no big deal. Just looking at Twitch, you sneak. All right. Pay no attention to the red circles that are faded out. Nope. Don't do that. All right. Anyway. As you travel through the woods and begin to go a little bit north than you do west, you hit a particular dense area of foliage. Now, those of you with land navigation, Evan Lucas, Slicks, Luther, and Chance, you have it as well, right? Yes.
Roadwise.
Roadwise. You have okay. This affects your roadwise as well because you're now on a trail that is just very, very, very light. You know that in many instances of terrain, these dense spots, these naturally dense spots, are ripe for ambushes, monster attacks, mercenary kind of tolls, etc. So you're aware. You're keeping an eye out, obviously. I'm sorry. I don't want to tell you what your characters are doing, so I should say this. Would it make sense for those of you who are adequately trained to be keeping an eye out?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Excellent. Excellent. Probably. Excellent. Good. Now, I just realized something here. I made a bit of an error. I didn't make tokens for you, so we might have to take a moment and make you tokens. But, I know, because nothing is going to happen at all. No. Anyway. Slicks, I want you to give me another roll for a chance to smell. Luther, I want you to give me another roll for detect ambush.
Okay. Oh, nice.
Good success there. Slicks, you still with us?
Yeah, I just had to restart roll 20 real quick.
No problem.
Yeah, by 10.
Okay. Slicks, this area itself has quite a few new scents towards you. I'm not too sure, you know, how much experience your character has had in areas that are rife with mold and rot and flowers and, you know, 20 different species of plants and trees.
Well, considering he spent most of his life in Lone Star, Dallas, probably not.
Yeah, probably not. So your senses are a little overwhelmed at this point, which makes it a little bit tricky. However, Luther, for just a split second, out towards your right, far ahead, approximately 60 feet away, you see a small glint, a silvery glint of metal that sticks out for a moment.
Like, and it strikes me the wrong way.
Oh, without a doubt. You know, trees aren't made out of metal.
So he'll call out to everybody, I think, somebody in the trees over there.
Okay. So, forewarned in regards to this, hearing this over your radio or via shout, whatever you prefer, what do you guys want to do in response? You're making your way, you know, north. Nothing suddenly has happened just yet, but Luther calls out.
I'll start pulling to a stop and start getting my rifle out.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll break over to the side.
Okay.
Evan will just say over the radio, maybe we should try to talk this out first.
Okay.
People don't sit in ambush to talk.
I mean, they might be warranted.
I ain't gonna stop you from trying, but...
Ants is readying his ion blaster.
Okay.
Preparing my rifle.
Alright. Yeah. So... I'm assuming those in the hover cycles have come to a stop as well, as you're gathering. So I'm going to take this moment, because I do want to... I really should just have icons for all of you. So I can do this real quick, super quick and dirty, because I'm not too sure if... I know some of you, quite a few of you, actually have character photos, right? Especially like you, Jordan, and... you know, others, right? So how about this? If you have a character photo, quickly send it to me via Discord, and I can make a very quick token with that, right? If you don't have one, I can just make a token with, like, your character's name on it. Sound good?
Yep.
All right. I have this awesome token tool, so this is not going to take nearly as long. So my deepest apologies for those of you who are watching the stream right now. You might want to skip ahead, like, 5 minutes or just chill out and listen to us banter, but I was in a rush after work today, so I didn't have a time to do as much pre-game prep, and honestly, the tokens did slip my mind, so. Bad Inferno. Okay, tokens. Token tool. What?
I don't know, I'm just looking for it.
Oh, okay. Ah, there's Jason's. Great. Discord full screen. There we go. Oh, there's Travs. Okay. Hey, it's your Discord photos. That's all even right. Better. Okay. I'm going to put you in green because you're the good guys.
Totally. Alleged good guys.
Good.
Yeah, I couldn't figure out how to change the roll 20 picture.
Right.
So.
No, yeah, don't worry about it. I can handle it. All right. All right. Screenshot.
Goodness gracious me.
Goodness gracious me. All right.
Professional.
Professional! All right. Jason, we got you. Save token as on desktop. Okay, Evan Lucas. Okay. Trav, doing you right now. Clicky, clicky, clicky. Your text, okay. Oh, there's Victoria. Beautiful. Looks so bookish.
But
I think that might be the... Oh, perfect. Hence the suggestion to, you know, talk.
She didn't talk. She didn't suggest that. She drove to the side of the road.
Oh, yeah.
She's going to hide in the vehicle.
Oh, even braver. Okay. Oh, my goodness. You all have almost pictures. The only one who might not is... Who is it? We got...
Chance.
I don't have one uploaded, but I sent one to you. I don't know if it'll work, though.
Oh, yeah, it is. Okay, no, it'll work. All pictures will work. I have this very robust tool, so we're good. So save that. Chance. All right, Matthew Miller. Should have done this way beforehand. Bill me for the extra minutes, everyone. Inferno, you owe us 20 more minutes because you couldn't token. There's our boy Slicks. And last, but certainly not least, is Chance. What? It's hilarious. It's a GIF. That's funny. I can do it, but it won't. I'll get it mid smirk. How's that sound?
Perfect.
All right. Jeez Louise, Jams, really. Okay. Now I just have to upload them one by freaking one. All right. This is wait, everyone. I have something for this. I have something for this. There we go. Missing you.
it into the ace.
I don't think, maybe I didn't save it. God darn it. That's okay, I can do it again real quick. I'm good technology. Technical difficulties, please stand by. Already. Come on, Evan Lucas, where are you hiding? On my desktop. Oh, just because you're a PNG. Oh, there was no shortcut for it. I'm a jerk. You were here all along in our hearts, Evan.
That's where I belong. Especially yeah. After my character.
Alright, now we just have to organize you. Watch,
sure
I'm gonna get freaking copyright protection for freaking Spanish flavor.
Just wait for it.
Watch, to be like, there was this 10-minute section of your video, Inferno, that no one could see anything. It's just you moving icons around. What happened? I feel like Spanish flavor. Spanish flavor did it. But now you all have your icons, and I'll make sure you'll be able to control them all. All will be well. Part of the Roll20 experience. And don't worry, Tolkeen people, I'm gonna remember. Flash forward next week when I say, oh shit, I didn't make your tokens! That's what's gonna end before that.
I'm assuming you become part of this campaign.
Mm-hmm.
Just to try it.
People will just be like, Inferno just wants to listen to Spanish. We're gonna just make sure. We're almost done. Beautiful. All right, goodbye, Spanish Flea. I love you. All right, so where were we? Oh, yes. You guys are getting out of your vehicles, slowing them down. A.K.A. hiding inside ATVs or something similar. Feel free to move yourselves. Anyway. Anywhere kind of like from here downward. Okie dokie.
Just gonna move myself off the map.
No, not not that downward.
I'm joking.
Okay. Alright. And as you slowly get, oh, not slowly, but as you get out of your, warily and carefully, get outside of your vehicles, sure enough, you can now hear the about half a dozen heavy footsteps moving away from this kind of fallen woolen tree. Give me a moment as I definitely don't select anybody.
I observe Inferno in the wild twitch.
Yep. Okay. The individual who seems the most verbose is a short, approximately 4 foot, 8 inch DB that is a very kind of mousy looking. Perhaps another fellow mutant Slicks, or maybe some other sort of alien. They're all in body armor, with the exception of two individuals. This individual here that I'm pinging is clearly a broadkill demon. They are 7 feet tall, made of muscles, and this one in particular has a bionic leg and arm. The arm itself has a very intimidating-looking ion cannon attached to it. The other individual here appears to be a partial conversion Borg, wearing a mix of both body armor and their own natural bionics. The other three individuals, the DB and the two humanoids, are in pretty, what appears to be some sort of custom-made body armor, perhaps stitched together from both the Explorer, the Gladiator types, maybe a little bit of Plastic Man as well. It's pretty patchwork, but it seems to have been done very skilled, in which, as they very coolly and confidently walk out, all of them brandishing weapons, but not directly pointing them towards you, the small, mousy-like mutant speaks up in a high, tinny voice. "Well, I see you're smart enough to sense us. Now let's hope you're smart enough to deal with us. We've laid claim to this area for quite some time, and you've landed in our trap. Now, of course, we could do what everyone wants to do, or thinks they want to do, and blast our ways through it. But I assure you, you'll end up dead, and we will end up with all of your stuff. However, we understand that there's a small risk here, so instead, we will just simply ask for a tax. We need food, medical supplies, and, well, we couldn't say no to a weapon or two. You brandish those to us, and we'll let you go on your way. So, before you reach for your triggers, grab hold of your wits."
"You think he came up with that one on his own?"
"No, it's obviously scripted. Come on now."
Just reading it right off.
Like, he can read or something? Like, he got that from somewhere?
Yeah, no, he probably can't read. Somebody told him.
I don't know, DBs aren't known for their intelligence.
No, if he is a mutant, he definitely probably will not read.
So we gonna just... So we're just gonna open up on these guys, or do we talk to them?
Well, do you guys want to just pay the tax?
Chance's first inclination would be to try to schmooze him, but I'm just trying to figure out what he would say.
Okay, well, you could take a moment. You know, out of character, you know, the player might take a moment. In character, your character might just be witty enough. You only need a few seconds to think of something, so don't feel rushed.
I know. I want to charm him in some way, like slowly and softly, tell him that was, "Sir, that was a beautiful speech. Have you ever thought about a career in television?" And I'm gonna try and charm him.
Okay. All right. Go ahead and roll your chance to charm and intimidate. Go ahead. Succeed by 5. Okay. I'm just going to call him the mouse mutant. The mouse mutant pauses for a moment. He says, "I don't know if you're joking or not. Television, vidpix, I'm a far way away from that. And you don't look like no traveling agent."
I'm going to procure a business card. that says a Chance Masterson.
You have Scout. Chance Masterson business cards?
Comes prepared.
No, if you do, so you'll okay. So
I don't
go ahead.
It's something that I figured that he would. I've done a lot of thinking about my character since I submitted my character.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. No, I'm not. I'm not challenging that. I'm just like, wow, you have these. Okay.
That was have business cards.
Okay.
Right? He schmoozes people for a living. Right?
Okay. All right. I like that. I like it. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
I'm gonna like reach out for it, but not like step towards him, threatening at all. Just have it out so that he can look at it.
Okay. Now. Awesome. I'm going to, like, resolve that interaction. Now, just heads up with the rest of you folks, right? If you want to do something while Chance is doing his own thing, talk with each other, whatever, time is a very flexible thing in my campaigns. So once we're done resolving that scene, you can say, Inferno, while he was doing this, I would like to do that, all right? So we can always go back up in time a bit. Groovy?
Mm-hmm.
All right, I just don't want anyone to feel pigeonholed or anything like that. So Chance.
I'd also like to use my trust intimidate if I can. I want him to trust me on this.
Oh, okay. Yeah, we will. We'll get into that. Actually, pre-roll it. Go ahead and do trust and intimidate.
Yes.
Okay. All right.
31.
This is what I love about this game. The last thing I expected was someone to brandish the business card. But okay, so Chance, you reach for your business card, and instinctively... The rat mutant and his four compadres start to kind of lift up their weapons towards you in a kind of instinctive way as you reach for it. But as in your hands, instead of a weapon, you're just brandishing this small white card, they look confused for a moment, in which the mouse mutant highwayman says, what's that?
It's a business card. It's got my name, my business, a little logo right here, and some contact information.
Wait, you weren't joking?
No, sir.
Keep an eye on them, says the mouse mutant to the others as the others kind of carefully go his way. But he lowers his weapon. He says, okay, I'm going to put my weapon down. I want to take a look at this whole business card thing you got going on. What? And as he kind of slowly walking towards you.
I'll close the distance with him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm going to yell out, don't worry. Chance here, he's a great man. We've done this all around. Why do you think we travel with him? We're his bodyguards. Just to make sure everything goes well. Looking for star power, you know?
Stop there? Do I need to...
You can go ahead and stop there. That's fine.
With him so I can hand it to him.
The other individuals kind of look... at the leader expectantly. They kind of spread out a little bit as well, just in case. They're not too sure. Their weapons are there. They're not raised directly at you just yet, but they can get there in a moment as the rat mutant kind of closes the distance slowly and carefully now, warily, as he looks into Chance's eyes almost like for reassurance and like very... very gingerly, carefully reaches out and like plucks it from your hand like it's a grape, and he looks at it skeptically and he keeps turning the card over and over in his paws and he says, wait, what's your business again? You're looking for talent, like muscle talent, like fighting talent, or
like on-screen talent. See, we're heading up to Tolkeen. We decided to take the long way so we can run into some authentic individuals. Thinking about pitching their local television station on some real stories of roads in Rift's Earth. Yeah.
The hardships of the people out here, you know?
Yeah. One moment, he says. I gotta talk to my people. Don't go anywhere. Don't go anywhere.
I'll be right here.
Just hold up. And he gestures over to this, and he gestures this fellow here with the cowl, gestures him over, and he thrusts the cards into that. And he's not trying to be quiet. You can hear his tinny, ratty voice say, Read this. What does it say? And the guy very slowly in a deep baritone voice goes, Chance Matterson. What's the address?
Thank you.
What's the address, Chance? chance.
Ooh, it's going to be...
Oh, go ahead.
It's going to be a P.O. box
okay,
somewhere.
Can I just make it up? Am I cool to make it up?
Yeah, make it up.
Okay. P.O. box 372 Ishpeming 4972555. And the rat mutant kind of pauses for a moment. He goes, "Stay there, Alia. Look really tough. Okay, I got an idea. So sure enough, the broke kill demon flexes a little bit. The boar kind of flashes its hidden vibro blade in and out. You know, these guys are looking really intimidating. And then, big puffed up chest, the rat mutant says, "Well, so you're looking for talent, huh? You're looking for something for your show and stuff like that? Want to know what's really like out here in the frontier? Well, have you seen any of those vid action flicks? Like any of the ones like before the Cataclysm? Like stuff like that?"
Oh yeah. Big action movies. I think your group has exactly what it takes to be action superstars.
Yeah. You know
what?
We weren't always like out like this, you know. We had a good thing going. Yeah, back in the Manistique Imperium. You know, I even saw one of them pre-Cataclysm shows. It was called Death Hard or something like that. This guy had to climb this giant tower with glass in his feet, and you know, he had weapons and he shot everyone, and everyone like loved him, right? He was awesome. He was freaking awesome. And you know,
Bikaye, motherfucker.
Yeah, that exactly, as he says really excitedly, pointing towards you. And he says, Yes. I want to be like him. Can you make me like him?
I get him real close to him, put my arm around him. I'm going to say, you know, remakes are really big. People want to see things that they're familiar with. You could be the new Yippee-Ki-Yay, motherfucker.
I like that.
You know what? I'll even waive my fee for you, my introductory fee.
Okay, yeah.
On through. Uh-huh. You meet us in Tolkeen in 2 days at the Confident Heart at around...
Do you need a reminder?
No, we're at the Confident Heart at 1300 hours.
Yes. Oh, yes. Good job.
I want to meet him after that.
Okay. All right. So you can say 1600 hours, whatever you think.
Mm-hmm. 1600 hours.
Okay.
Discuss it. We'll put a proposal together, and then we'll go meet with the television studio, and you'll have than you could possibly get from our traveling group.
Proposal? What's this proposal thing that you're talking about?
Want to do something?
Yeah.
Right, and it requires other people. Uh-huh. You have to tell them that idea, and you have to tell them in a way that they're gonna want to do it. From a telling a proposal.
Like what I kind of did to you, right? Like you came up and I gave you a proposal to fight and die, or I pitched the idea of giving us some of your stuff. Like that?
Man, with Chance, my own proposal.
Yeah, man, Chance, this guy is a natural.
He's gonna do great.
Oh my goodness! Oh my goodness, guys! So the rat mutant kind of gives a big smile and he says, "Yeah, okay. Well, you know what? I got a proposal for you too. Okay. The way up to Tolkeen is pretty crazy. All right, we're not the only group of intrepid adventurers that have been down on their luck. There's a lot of contracts out there, but not everyone's getting them. And people are getting tense. Of course, all the monsters and other such things are all getting riled up. It's ripe for the picking, but it's also dangerous. How about we travel with you, give you a little extra muscle protection, and you can get to know a little bit more about us to help sell to this video, radio, whatever entertainment thing. That way, we'll know you're for real, right? Because you said you're going to Tolkeen. Why not have some company? And trust me, if we were going to rob you, we would have done so already. But this is our ticket back in, you see? I think we can help each other out. This is way better than medical supplies. Yeah, this is fame. This is fame, as he says excitedly.
Exactly, my friend. I'm going to turn and look at the group and see what I can kind of infer from how they're looking.
Slixa shrugs.
Victoria gives a nod.
Luther doesn't look happy.
Matt has a smile on his face and two thumbs up.
Yep. Evan has a smile on his face, one thumb up, and one thumb in his bag, probably on a grenade.
Okay. All right. And he says,
"Gentlemen, okay. Have your own transportation? Do you have your own vehicles around here?"
Yeah, we got beat up old ATV, just, you know, hidden, camouflaged out that way. We can go to it. He says, let's get off on the right foot. You can call me by my new stage name. You can call me Yippee-Ki-Yay, or Yip for short. How's that sound?
Yip.
Yip. That sounds pretty good, eh?
Yeah.
Or to a long and fruitful relationship.
Yeah. Okay, he says. As he goes, now let me just convince everyone else. You stay there, we'll go get our vehicle, and then we'll be on our way. And so, okay, I'm going to kind of narratively do this, but...
as soon as I'm able to, I'm going to get back to the group so that we can, like, hush talk if need be.
Here, okay, I'll let you guys hush talk first, and then I'll kind of explain what that group is doing, getting prepared to temporarily join up with you. You know, how come every time I throw bandits in front of people, they manage to talk their way out of it? To offer themselves up as whores.
We're the good guys.
We're not out of it yet. We're still
that is true. That's true. There is still a day away to Tolkeen. A lot can happen in 24 hours. You're right.
Some people can go missing in the wilderness. You never know.
Yeah, that's true. You never do.
Yeah. And so when Chance gets back, so I'm getting like, great idea, Chance. Great idea. But how about like you have them do some mic testing as I pull out a grenade?
Ooh. Is that necessarily the best move?
I mean, these guys are useful.
I think in Tolkeen we could actually make some money off of these guys, but...
Do you actually know people in Tolkeen?
I don't know these guys, but you see what I did here, right?
He doesn't. Oh, God. Oh, well, I mean, they're still useful, and at least they can die for us, right?
If anything, they're like a diversity hire. They will allow us to, like, we're not CS, we have DBs.
Right? It's definitely for our
company. We already have a ramp mutant. I don't want any more.
He waves.
Oh, that's not nice.
You can either slip them or take care of them when the time arises. But right now, we have the upper hand.
I say we keep them with us.
Well, if anything, they'll scale off others.
Yeah.
Bullet shields, you know, sponges.
Cannon fodder is useful, yes.
Fodder, that's what I was looking for.
Yeah. I mean, plus, I want to be a star. Matt says as he just whips his hair.
Gosh darn it, Matt.
I look good enough for that, right?
What's your personal beauty score out of character?
33.
Oh my God! How is that possible?
Mine's only 20.
Only 20.
You are as beautiful and as I am dexterous.
Oh my God. Anywho. Anywho, back on track.
Must be stars.
Let's be stars. Let's get famous.
This is very uncoalition-like.
Screw the war, we're going to Hollywood.
Don't say that too loud! Jane Long is gonna murder you. So they didn't come back. They've become stars. You A-list, you have that option.
With all of us on it.
By the way, you guys have this option. This is a free campaign. You can do whatever you want. Anyways.
Just go. We're on the hitting the road, guys. Pack it up. We're going to the big city. We're gonna live out our dreams. Live off the land.
Okay. Anywho. Alright, anything else you guys want to discuss? Are you guys pretty much at a consensus here? Because you're right, it's a long journey, but I just wanna, you know.
They can follow us for now.
Okay, alright. Everyone's cool with them following with you guys for now?
Yep.
Yeah, Six would just say, let's just get them to the city, then ditch them.
Okay.
Well, it could still be useful even in the city. I mean, if we do run into trouble in the bar or whatever, if we do run into trouble in the bar, they could, well, if we need to get our people out, have a mock acting shoot of sorts.
Slicks just shrugs. This is too much for him.
If I made sense.
I'm okay with this.
I made sense, right? I made sense.
God says yes, it made sense.
Sure, Matt.
We could easily use them to stage distractions. We could probably even use them for counterintelligence in some form, just like lookouts.
Yeah, I mean, it's just acting, right?
Yep.
Okay.
For an espionage scene.
Yeah, yeah. A spy flick. Yippee-ki-yay. Yeah.
I hate that name.
We need to talk about that.
Alright. Am I good sorry, go ahead.
No.
Am I good to describe what your new friend Yippee Kaye and his compadres are doing?
Yes, please do.
Okay. So Yip. Also has, while you guys are huddling your heads together, they're huddling their heads together as well. And at first, the conversation doesn't seem to be very well. In particular, the broad-killed demon, you hear repeatedly him say the word, "Stupid! Stupid!" And "Stupid!" over and over again. As Yip seems to almost be having a temper tantrum, until finally all five of them at least agree. To at least check this out to see if they're for real. You also overhear Yip cajole some of the others, being like, listen, we'll be an actual city with real opportunities, with real possible job contracts. These guys can be our ticket back into Tolkeen, right? Etc. So, some of them eagerly, but most of them begrudgingly go to get their personal vehicle, which is a Big Boss ATV that looks like it's been slightly customized. Very similar to the patchwork armor, there appears to be a patchwork extension onto the Big Boss itself. Four of the individuals fit inside the vehicle, but on the very top is a custom turret with a large plasma cannon that's guided by the Broadkill, who is sitting in a giant exposed, like, open turret on the top of the Big Boss ATV. He, as the ATV rolls out, you can see that the partial conversion Borg is in the driver's seat. Yip is in the passenger seat, and he kind of rolls down the window. He says, "Okay, we're good to go." And the Broadkill is just, oh man, if looks could smash, that Broadkill is not happy. But he doesn't turn the turret towards you. He is just very quiet and sullen, and you just hear underneath his voice, "Stupid," from time to time during your
journey. When that happens, Lux just nods to himself in agreement.
I feel you, Broadkill Demon. I feel you.
I wanted to shoot things.
Hey, Victoria, do you know any weaknesses for that roadkill? Does silver work on him?
Well, TM, do I?
Well, do you have any sort of monster or demon lore?
Demons are monsters.
You do?
Yep.
Then roll it, Victoria.
All right.
Ooh.
Thanks, Rolled. Coming up hot.
You fail by a bit.
Just a bit.
All you know of roadkill demons is that their skin is extremely durable, so conventional weapons such as ballistic bullets would bounce right off of them, but they are damaged by anything from lasers to plasma, high-tech weaponry. You don't know that they're susceptible to anything else. You do know that they can turn invisible at will, if necessary, if they want to. You've heard rumors of roadkilled demons doing that, and that makes them kind of excellent hunters and predators, pardon the pun. And they also have a real fascination with bionics, which actually doesn't interfere with their innate invisibility. That's the extent of knowledge and vulnerabilities that you know of roadkill demons right off the top of your head. If, you know, things change, you get new information, I'll let you roll again. Sound good?
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Well, I'm not too familiar with roadkill. I do know that they are not, they're resistant to low velocity weaponry. So pick something hard hitting. They can also turn invisible at will and have a fascination with bionics and cybernetics. So keep that in mind.
Huh.
I'm gonna make sure Silver is loading my guns just to be safe.
Just in case. Nothing wrong with that.
Maybe we could even run him over.
I do not want to be the one running him over.
I mean, it meant win, not run. I can't, that's gonna damage our bike.
Keep your voice low, you don't know how well they hear.
Yeah. At best, we can send some cyber snatchers on him.
Okay.
Broadkill. Have fun.
I'd like to work it so that Ravan is following behind this bandit group.
So you want to make sure your convoy is followed behind them. So do you all of you want to follow behind these guys, or do you guys want to have some behind, some ahead?
That's not a driver.
That's what my suggestion would be.
Okay, all right.
I would assume the ATV would want to be behind.
Okay.
Maybe one or two higher cycles up front, but ATV definitely behind.
Okay. ATV definitely behind. Any volunteer hover cycle up front?
Matt, go up front.
I could too. It didn't matter to me.
Mm-hmm. All right. We'll say Matt then. Or both of you. How about that? A good kind of...
Sure, both.
Okay. Yeah. Perfect. So with the hover cycles up front, followed by the ragtag ATV, the custom-built, not super mechanically impressive, but that cannon's not half bad, that plasma cannon's not half bad, followed by the ATV, you prevent any sort of fisticuffs and instead have some, hope, maybe, very temporary allies or very permanent long-term contacts, depending on what happens.
It could also turn very sour and have, you know, long-term enemies, but...
Yeah, but, you know, let's stay optimistic, right? Mm. Okay, I definitely rolled that 1d100 for no reason. As I'm going to take us back to just a little intro screen here, I think, until we get to our next scene of interest. You can go away, Miss Long.
Boop. She pops back.
Hello! I've been inside this trunk the entire time, monitoring your progress. No.
It was a test.
It's an amazing trick. I know this awesome variety show. They're looking for talent.
So I'm going to kind of move the travel to Tolkeen ahead just a little bit. I said it would take you about a day to reach the Tolkeen gates, which means you, since you departed at 8 a.m., you would arrive at Tolkeen between 8 and 9 p.m. as well. On your way, continuing your path through the rest of the wilderness, you're able to clear it without much issue. In addition, over the radio, Yip does give a suggestion of a small shortcut. Do you guys take the shortcut, or do you say, forget about you and go on our own?
Can he describe the shortcut to us?
Sure. He says he knows of a few military checkpoints, and being intrepid adventurers, they like the path of least resistance, which is why they were hiding out in the woods. Perhaps avoiding these checkpoints not only wouldn't slow you down, but prevent any sort of needless complications.
Can I use my land nav or wilderness survival to see if this is truthful?
It's hard to validate the intel, but tell you what. According to your character background, would you at least kind of try to keep tabs on, we'll just say the Wisconsin area?
Yes, it is okay. My job to just travel all around.
Okay, I like that. I like that quite a bit. So that makes a lot of sense to me. So tell you what. I'm going to give you a modified roll to your land navigation and give you a 70% chance of success. Does that sound fair?
Yep.
All right, so roll D100, get 70 or lower. You get a 9.
Best rolling of the night, guys.
Well,
11 out of 10.
That's okay, 11 out of 10. Okay, well, once again, it's just a fail by 9, not a durr or anything like that. So, you can confirm for sure that especially due to this heightened coalition presence, there are definitely, compared to 2-3 years ago, there are probably 5 times the amount of checkpoints, scouts, and other such things. So that intel checks out no problem. Those exact locations that Yip is suggesting, I love this stupid name, by the way, that Yip is suggesting is 50-50, right? You've heard rumors around those areas, but you don't have concrete proof. But it seems at least plausible to you.
All right. I'll say we go with him. If he leads us somewhere, we can shoot him. And military checkpoints aren't really the best around this time.
Agreed. Would intelligence be a skill I could use?
Yes, most definitely. What's your IQ skill? What's your IQ stat, that is?
It is 15.
15? 1-5?
Yeah. Okay. And then I have the intelligence skill at 47.
Oh, when you said intelligence, I thought you meant IQ. No, okay, you know what? Do intelligence, the skill. Unmodified, though, so the stick 40, the base 47.
Can this be for anyone who has a skill?
Yes, this is. I'm sorry. I guess, yeah, if you have the intelligence skill, yeah, for sure. Oh, boy. Go, Senno. Getting a high roll.
Yes!
Yay! Slicks!
Just throw dice at it.
Throw dice at the problems.
All right. So it looks like... Oh, Luther's typing. Okay, no. Okay, we're good. All right, so Slicks. So... Oh, sorry, by the way, Luther and Victoria, with your intelligence rolls, very, very similar to what I told Evan Lucas, right? It sounds plausible, but these specific points, you don't have that right at the tip of your mind. However, Slicks, I don't know. Can we tie this into your background or anything like that? I'm just wondering.
I was trained specifically for these type of things.
Yeah,
like
yeah.
Sneaking
yeah,
in yeah. Infiltrating places.
Yeah, yeah, you were. So tell you what. On your Slicks, on your last infiltration mission, you had some intel over a 25-mile radius of the next checkpoints the Tolkeen military and militia had in mind for the next 3 months. Fortunately for you, this intel that you gathered completely syncs with your current situation. And you can mentally confirm that the checkpoints that Yip is suggesting does check out 100%.
All right. Styx will raise up his eyes. Unfortunately, the mutant mouse creature is correct.
All right. Good info, Styx.
Okay. Nice.
So, hold on. Go ahead. All right. So, with Styx confirmation, are you guys comfortable, you know, taking Yip's shortcut?
Yep.
Good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you take the shortcut, and it leads you a little bit, slightly further north than your original trajectory. But thanks to it as well, you're able to kind of thread the needle between two possible Tolkeen checkpoints. At a period of time, you do have to kind of gun your vehicles, and the little ragtag matchmaking ATV also tries to hit it into its highest gear, which unfortunately is only about 70% of the acceleration of your current vehicles. And a lot of smoke is coming out the back, but it doesn't break down or anything like that. It's just pushed really, really hard until...
Well, I'm not running behind it.
Until approximately midnight, it is suggested to kind of turn down your headlights and kind of camp out in a small, very lightly forested grove for the night, because Yips also suggests that because of these checkpoints, they're kind of roaming checkpoints, and interestingly enough, they tend to be actually more active at night during the daytime because they are paranoid of enemy infiltration for some reason. So Yip suggests that this is a perfect time to lay low and to continue the rest of the journey early in the morning hours, around 5 or 6 o'clock. You guys, you and the party, can mentally confirm that this will get you at Tolkien's Gates at 9 o'clock a.m. So if you rest here for the evening, right, for about 6 hours, you're only going to be 1 hour behind, and you'll still have a day in which to, like, a full day in Tolkeen before you reach, you know, when you have to meet someone at the Confident Heart. That Sarkin fellow. Make sense?
It's only 1 hour, so.
Yeah. It's no big deal, really.
Yep.
Okay. So. As your newest friends, Yips and his compatriots, kind of break camp, they begin to take out a few tents, a few bedrolls outside of their ATV. Kind of set up a camp in their own kind of area, right? During this, I have a couple NPC interactions with you guys, if you guys are open to them.
Sure.
Oh, yep. Okay, but it sounds like you guys want to have a little consensus here. You can move this conversation between Victoria and Lucas, you know, talky-talky instead of typey-typey, if you prefer.
I don't really care.
Okay, well, go ahead. Give you some spotlight here.
Player, I don't care if you guys want to kill these guys in their sleep. That would be interesting. Chance wants to try and avoid conflict because he doesn't like wearing his armor. It chafes.
Oh my god.
It doesn't look very flattering in it.
Oh my god. My only problem with that is it's hard to kill a Borg in his sleep.
Yeah, and the broad kill is a major threat.
Yeah.
Yeah, they are still useful.
Sleep?
Do Borg sleep?
Huh.
Yes.
Okay.
They have human brains. The human brain itself gets fatigued. They don't need to sleep as much, right? But of course they need to sleep. Or they go crazy if they stayed up all the time.
I would like to try to get rid of these guys, because I would rather not have them bothering us in Tolkeen while we have to do stuff. But
I would rather not have to explain them also at the gates of Tolkeen.
Look, I can feel it just be more useful to keep them along for now, and maybe go a different route than the gates. Maybe through the black market, they might have connections.
Couldn't we just go through the gates and then tell the guards we're not with them?
That is also a possible solution.
We definitely have a fight on our hands when we come out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We have to kill them either then or now.
Yeah.
I say we just bring them with us and deal with them as we go.
Just to see how this plays out.
Yeah, right. Not just to see how this plays out, but just how useful they could just be randomly at some point.
Just keep in mind, this will be going to my report.
Great.
Great, you're one of those people.
I'm going to do the paperwork too, so...
Okay.
So are they sleeping in their vehicle or on the ground?
No, they're going to be sleeping on the ground. They're getting their equipment set up for...
Okay.
Yeah, for so resting on the ground. Yeah.
Do we
so
have...
I can't shove a grenade in the fuel gauge?
It'd be tricky because they're kind of setting up around their vehicle, kind of caravan style. Instead of, circling the wagons around where they sleep, they're circling where they sleep around their wagon. But as they get themselves settled down, I have a couple interactions for you guys if you're open to them.
Yep.
Sure.
Okay.
Absolutely.
All right. The first one is your good friend Yip, and he's the one who is clearly the most social and also clearly the most excited about this idea about being a star, So he spends most of his time in your camp, so to speak, talking with Chance and whoever would listen to him. So he'll first maybe approach Chance, and he says, So, tell me, what else have you done? Have I known you from anything else? Did you put on any other shows or anything like that?
Just out of character, can I just make up the name of like a famous actor or something?
Yeah. Let's
see what I want to go with.
How about Zip Brio?
I like Zip Brio. Yeah. Okay. So Chance would look Yip straight in the eye and be like, Zip Brio.
Zip Brio. Zip Brio. Yeah. He says, and you can kind of tell by his face that he's pretending to know what you're talking about. Yeah, I think I've heard of him. Yeah, he's pretty big. He's pretty famous. You've dealt with him. You've gotten him work.
Found him.
Oh, you found him. You
taking care of pigs on a farm.
Really? He says like excitedly. His stupid mouse ears twitching in excitement.
Okay. Found taking care of pigs on a farm. I just knew when I saw him, he's off, and that's a beautiful man. Big star.
Okay. All right. Cool. Yip would then say, oh, wow. And then you can kind of, he brings his hand to like your shoulder, not your shoulder, your elbow. It kind of pulls you aside, so like only you and him are talking. And he says, So be honest with me, okay? Like, I know we just met and it was under like rough circumstances, and I know I got like a pretty great way of words. I got a really good memory and I've heard some really awesome speeches in my time. But do you really see all my friends as potential stars too? I mean, some of them look tough, but some of them, I don't know if they got, like, the personality for it. Like, give me your honest opinion.
I'm gonna, I'll look at him, and then I'll look back at his group. Well, hand on chin kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
The big fella.
the broad kill?
Yeah, I'm gonna look at Yip and I'm gonna say that. Tell me about the big fella, and I'll motion towards the broad kill.
Oh, Thunk. We found him. He was a really good muscle, but he's a little too rough around the edges. He doesn't like this whole fame idea. He kind of joined with us with the smashing and the grabbing type of thing. So Thunk ain't really there for show business, and frankly, he doesn't really like this idea as well, but I kind of promised him a percentage of my profits for him just to go along and behave himself, so... Yeah, you know, once we reach Cult Tolkeen, we'll just cut him loose. You know, he'll sign on with some other group, I'm sure.
Like you, Yip. You're a very shrewd businessman.
Well, he says, I guess. I got wits. I got brains for this operation. This whole idea was mine, and look where it brought us, right? Yeah. Yeah, okay. Well, I'm going to just kind of smooth things out and make sure everything's fine on my side. There's no sore feelings or anything like that. Wasn't he just there a moment ago as he points towards the weapon tower where Thunk was just when you were gesturing towards him? He goes...
Panic.
That's okay. It's fine. Thunk also really likes to hunt. So he's probably just doing that. He's just, he likes to eat, like, raw meat. So he'll come back. But right now, the Yip is looking, like, really nervous. And he kind of gives, like, a chittering laugh and goes, okay, see you in the morning.
Sleep well, Yip.
Yeah, thanks.
I get his cold. I'm going to go in back into the big boss ATV as long as it's, like, not locked or anything. Uh-huh. Just going to get in, close myself inside.
Okay, so I close myself inside. Okay, so while this is happening, Victoria, there is one of the other strangers, this former highwayman, one of these intrepid adventurers, approaches you. It's the gentleman in the dark cowl and the custom armor itself. And he moves over towards you in a very smooth, almost fluid manner in body language. And his voice is like a whisper on the leaves, short and crisp, as he says, "You may have to adjust your expectations."
How so?
Our talkative entrepreneur leader is extremely enthusiastic. However, two members of our party have significant bounties by the Tolkeen law enforcement, and I doubt they'll be able to enter. You may need to adjust your expectations.
Thank you for the advice.
I am not one of these people. And frankly, I am a survivor. It is why I was with them. But if the opportunity arises, I can allow my loyalty to become a little bit more fluid. If there is a issue at any sort of border check, please rest assured that I will not go down fighting like my outlaw companions.
Thank you. That will be useful.
There's no need to thank me, says the stranger. I'm merely surviving, and I mainly just want to keep my neck with those who are a little bit more cool-minded. You could have easily drawn your weapons against us, but you didn't. It shows some foresight. Perhaps in time I will introduce myself fully and my name. But until then, heed my advice and keep your eyes out for opportunity.
Of course.
He gives a polite nod. And just as fluid as he approached you, he heads back towards his tent. So, Luther, what are you doing?
Probably sitting, like on the bike, but like mm-hmm. not like side saddle, I guess. Just kind of, it's sitting on the ground. He's sitting on it. It's probably checking over his guns, making sure he's got silver in them and stuff mm-hmm. like that. Mm-hmm.
Roll me D100, please. Okay. While you're checking your ammo, your equipment, sitting side saddle on your hover bike, suddenly, in front of you, comes back into reality from his invisibility cloak, the Broadkill Demon. He is a mere 2 feet in front of you, in a very intimidating posture, his chest puffed out. His bionic weapon with its ionic cannon attachment, not pointed directly at you, but he's making it really clear that you can see it. It's within your eye level. And Thunk, the Broadkill, says, "Stupid. You stupid."
He'll let out a bit of a start and almost fall backwards off the
being startled. You scared and stupid. Weak.
He'll kind of just look at him and wait for him to say what he wants.
Good. The Broadkill leans over his large frame. He says, "I like you, weak, stupid man. I hunt you last." And with that, he disappears from sight again.
Alright.
Alright. So, what would you guys like to do over the rest of the night?
Alright. Slicks over the night would like to get into the trees and just keep an eye on our fellow travelers. Mm-hmm. Very stealthily. He himself would like to consider himself a hunter.
I'm going to lock the doors to the ATV.
Okay. Alright.
Probably won't stop Thunk, but...
I'm going to take Matthew a small bit away from the camp mm-hmm. and help him camouflage himself and find a better place to sleep than an open field with a bunch of random DBs.
What? What's wrong?
I didn't get this far learning to trust everyone. Just, you know, take this camouflage and we can sleep a little bit away from camp. I'll wake you up earlier than the moment. It'll be like nothing happened.
So I suggest we, instead of doing what they're doing and circling the wagon, we should circle our wagons around us.
Thoughts, party?
Slicks was still going to do what he wanted to do.
Okay.
ATV is made of mega damage metal. Just going to put
that there. Yeah, I'm just going to have my hover bike kind of near the ATV in a way that possibly the other one could form the rest of the circle. But if he didn't want it to, it doesn't have to.
Okay. Fair enough. Give everyone options, right? Okay. So the question is now, how do you guys decide to rest? Do you want to rest in shifts? Do you all just want to get a little bit of shut eye and not the full 6 hours? What's your sleep schedule like, my friends?
About six people.
We have, what, 5 people and 6 hours of sleep? We can all take, like, a 2-hour shift of being awake?
I think Luther, I don't know, he probably won't be getting much sleep because he doesn't trust that Broadkill at all.
Well, he did say, "I'll hunt you last," so I kind of don't blame him.
Like, Got to make sure that I'm not last.
Yeah. How many first
places? This plan is bulletproof.
Make sure the others are alive. That way, I'm not last.
Isn't that the old saying? You don't have to be faster than the line. You just have to be faster than the person next to you.
If we want, everyone can take a 2-hour shift, and I'll take a 4-hour shift. That way, we'll all get the full 6 hours of sleep.
Mm-hmm. That's fine. Sticks would suggest he would do it since he's kind of tending towards a night person. He is a rat.
I'm a wilderness person.
Okay. All right.
Just gonna hide an ATV under a blanket.
So I'm gonna go shift 1, shift 2, shift 3 by the sounds of it, because you guys are gonna be mostly doing 2-hour shifts with the exception of one of you who's doing 4. All right. Yep. So I'm just gonna organize it just so we can get it, you know, going relatively quickly, you know. So okay, who wants to be awake the first shift?
I will. I'll actually spend the time. Chance will spend the time putting his armor on.
Okay, Chance. All right. Who wants to take the second shift?
I will.
Okay. Who was that? Sorry.
Matt,
there you are. Okay, sorry, Matt.
It's fine.
All right, Matt. Okay.
I'll take the third one with 4 hours instead of 2.
Okay, that was Jason, right?
Yep.
Okay, sweet. Yay! Oh, so I'm still learning voices and stuff. All right, and that was Luther. No, that was Slicks. Slicks, sorry. All right, Evan Lucas. And Slicks. So,
Luther will probably have a 4-hour shift in there somewhere too, because, like, probably the first couple, because he isn't going to be going to sleep for a bit.
All right. Sorry, who?
Luther.
That's what I thought. Okay. So maybe I'll put you in the first group with Chance.
Sure.
Does that work? Okay. And you're going to extend, since it's 4 hours. You'll actually extend into Matt's as well. So Luffy, yeah. You're technically with Chance and Matt. And Slicks, you'll be technically with Matt and Evan. Because right. Yours is 4 hours. Okay, that makes sense. So the only person that we're waiting for is, or who needs to be assigned to a shift, if they choose to take one, is Victoria.
I'll take middle shift.
All right, so big heavy on the middle, which is probably a good idea. Probably a really good idea.
Everything goes in the middle.
Okay, perfect. So sleep 2 hours, wake up for 2 hours, sleep for 2 hours. Okay. You guys get a couple sleep cycles each. You'll be good. Okay, so now for no reason, Inferno is going to roll a D100. Ooh.
No reason whatsoever.
Nope. Not at all. GMs don't like rolling dice. It's a myth. Oh, this is interesting. Okay.
Oh no.
I know it's awful when a GM says that too.
Ooh. Okay. I'm making a smile on their face.
Okay. So, everyone in Yip's camp beds down for the night. No one's seen the Broad Kill. But Yips just assures everyone that he's probably off wandering far, you know, getting something to eat. There's nothing to worry about, you know. He knows he's smart. He's smart. So the first hour of while Matt and Slicks and Victoria and Evan Lucas, have a rest in their respective areas, either camouflaged or inside their vehicles or next to the vehicles, whatever you determine. Chance and Luther, how are you keeping alert?
Unless someone tells him to do otherwise, Chance will just be sitting up in the ATV looking out the windows.
Okay, all right. And Luther?
Even though he doesn't like it, he feels very threatened.
Okay.
I guess just relying on his detect ambush skills and mm-hmm. just kind of just keeps doing whatever you do with that. I don't know.
Sure. No, that's okay. No, it's no big deal. No big deal. Sir, I was just more wondering, like, where your location? Are you going to be by your vehicle? Or are you going to be in the ATV as well? Are you going to be hanging closer to your friends who are, you know, sleeping, resting? Are you going to be walking a perimeter? You know, that type of thing.
I would say he's set up by his vehicle, but okay. The vehicle is kind of near where everybody's sleeping in the ATV.
Okay. Yeah, so you guys are pretty well clumped together. You guys aren't super spaced out or anything like that. You're staying close in case of anything, right? An exterior or interior threat.
So he's set up on that with his SDC rifle with silver in it, just hoping that that works against the roadkill.
Okay. You both, Chance and Luther, you hear about an hour and 15 minutes in a scraping noise. A scraping along the back window of your big boss ATV that you're in, Chance. It's like the sound of a nail on chalk or a nail on glass. And sure enough, these words are etched into the glass, almost as if they're made by a phantom hand.
So when I hear the glass scratching, I'm going to immediately turn towards it and just shoot at it with my...
He can spell, sort of.
All right.
Stupid.
Okay.
Not
to be worried about, guys.
But you're okay. Sorry. Who's shooting?
Luther,
you're shooting your laser pistol.
No, my SDC rifle.
Okay, you're shooting your SDC rifle. Oh my god, this game. Your SDC rifle in the direction of the scratching, right?
Yes.
Yeah, your window's Victoria. Okay. This is going to be a wild shot because you can't see your target. So go ahead and roll a 1d20. And
now, do I get my WP bonuses to this, or just straight 1d20?
No, you get your WP bonus for sure. So, like, your plus one. Well, actually, no. Plus one is like just to hit. A wild shot, I believe, with the Ultimate Edition rules, is you. It's just the roll. I'm 99% sure on that.
That is a crit.
Oh my nice. God.
Nice.
Oh my god. Roll damage.
Hold on, let me look that up.
The eye.
And that's silver bullets.
Okay, wait, I gotta check something real quick. I gotta check something. For no reason, I have to check something super quick. No reason. No, not that book.
Now, whether this does damage or not, I want to shoot him right between the eyes.
You know what? You got the natural 20, so yeah, you get the priority, my friend.
Oh, God.
Oh, there they are. Okay.
I guess in the end, he was stupid.
Natural abilities. Oh.
Like, if it doesn't hurt him, it'll just piss him off, but I think it'll be funny.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So you're gonna find out real quick they're actually not vulnerable to silver, but...
Damn it.
That's okay. Because you hit that fleshy part, like, right in between a person's eye, like, right on the bridge of their nose.
Yeah.
So although it doesn't break the skin, it's very clear that it gets a reaction. The scratching actually stops at the word stew, so the pet part isn't there. So it says stew. So you have that on your vehicle now, Victoria. It's now the Stewmobile.
Well, now the glass is gone, so.
So, and suddenly the Broadkill Thunk goes,
so stupid! I immediately drop my rifle and start getting out my laser rifle.
He says as he's like holding on to his nose. It's not bleeding or anything, but he seems really irritated, and he breaks his invisibility. And the gunshot and the shout, I think, would awaken almost anybody, right? Unless your character is a narcoleptic, or for whatever reason you don't want them to wake up, they can jolt up awake. Thunk's companions also wake up, and there's kind of a blurry, you know, they're grabbing their weapons, seeing what's up type of thing. As the Broadkills begins to, like, he's ignoring Luther grabbing their laser weapon, right? And he's, like, thumping around with his feet, like, holding the area in between his nose, being like, oh, hurt! Annoying! Stupid!
I would like to shoot him.
Okay.
As soon as I can see him, I'd like to shoot him as well.
Oh, my goodness. All right. Guys, we're going to roll for initiative now.
Okay. The initiative thing. So I should wait to shoot till then?
Yeah. Wait. I'll give you guys priority, but I'm going to give you guys in the Discord a copy of the Google spreadsheet. This is amazing. Oh, wait, shit, that was in chat. Chat, ignore that. Shit. Now I'm going to have 100 people writing in their own stuff. Please, seriously, don't do that. I gave it to... That was in the Discord. Please don't.
You're going to get someone griefing the thing again?
No, I hope not. You had one job. I'm being screamed at.
I don't
have
permission.
Yeah, we don't have permission.
Okay, good. Good, you guys can't do it. Never mind. I made it private only to me.
There was a reason for that, I guess.
Yep.
Inferno, you're about to share a link.
I'm going to get a shareable link. And that this link, for sure, I will not put in the chat. Now let me know.
There it is.
Everyone, don't listen to Spicy in the chat, everyone. Bad. Oh my goodness, Google Drive. I know, I don't care. All right. Are you guys in?
Yep.
Okay. So I'm going to put in Thunk. All right. For the sake of the flow of the game, I'm going to just describe what the other NPC companions are doing, because I don't think they're going to want to get into this melee. They're not stupid, right? So I'm going to leave all these T's below that there. But go ahead. And for those of you who are interested in taking part of combat, engaging with Thunk, put in your character and your initiative roll. Character name and initiative roll, and fill in with T's the amount of attacks you have. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask.
And I'm in view only.
You're in view only?
I'm also in view only.
We're in view only.
Dang it! Okay, never mind, then I'll just do it, just for the sake of simplicity. This is probably good that you guys are in view only for now. Okay, so, wait, let me just do Thunk here real quick. Roll 1d20 plus 2. Okay, Thunk got 15. All right. Okay, I need a volunteer. Who wants to be the first person in?
Chance, I got a 4.
Sorry, who? Chance. Okay, sorry, Chance. You cut out there. I heard ants, and I'm like, who's ants? You got a 4? Okay, ants. How many attacks for melee do you have?
I have 4.
4. Perfect. All right, next person.
Evan, I also got a 4.
Okay, well. Evan. I'm just going to put Evan. All right, you also got a 4. What's your physical prowess, Evan?
My PP is a 22.
Okay, how about you, Chance?
a lot less than that.
Okay, so I'm going to bump Evan up to a 5. How many attacks per melee do you have, Evan?
6.
All right, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, next person.
Matthew, mm-hmm. I got a 19.
19, very nice. How many attacks?
4.
1, 2, 3, 4. Great. Next person. Is that it?
Luther?
Luther? Yeah, probably Luther. He's the one who started this. Mm. Luther!
Got a 25.
Uh-huh.
Luther?
I have 6.
Attacks?
6 actions.
6 actions, you're right. It should be actions per melee. Cool.
Yes, exactly.
Anyone else wants to take part of the thunk party?
Me, if I only have, like, one extra gun.
Yeah. Okay. How many... What's your initiative roll?
A whole 5.
A whole 5. Okay, and attacks?
4.
All right, Senno. 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Victoria. Sir, what was your initiative again?
5.
Okay.
I'm pretty sure it's lower than Evan's. So
Evan was technically a 4, so I'm going to put you as a 4.5. That'll help with the ranking, Evan. Okay. All right. Anybody else?
Slick's got 17.
Okay, 17.
He has 5 attacks per melee.
Okay. 4, 5. Slicks. 6? No, Slicks. Alright, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, that's all of you. Okay, you're all taking part. That's great. Thunk might be in trouble. Okay, Sword.
Thunk is in a whole lot of trouble. And then after him, the rest of his party, maybe.
Well, it's up to you. That's the exciting thing. Okay. So, Luther. You are going to say at this point you do have your laser weapon out, right? So you don't have to spend an action to do that.
All right, so there's 2 different modes for my shooting. It says there's 3d6 for a standard action, mm-hmm. or I can do a 66 for a full action.
Yes.
So I guess full action is just me standing there and then shooting him.
Yeah, and it would just use all your actions, yeah.
Okay, and then how do I take an aimed shot or a called shot?
A called shot is an aimed shot, right? It takes 2 attacks, and you get a +2 to strike. Make sense?
Right.
And in order to hit the area that you call, like say I want to shoot him. So it's a plus. Oh yeah, you're sharpshooter. No. I'm not surprised. I'm just surprised. All right. So it's a +6. So roll d20 +6. Get over 12. And you do.
That did it.
Nice. All right. So you go ahead. Roll damage. Oh no, my stream went down for a moment, but it's back up now. Sorry, everyone in Chatland. All right, 25. Wait a sec. Oh wait, there was some confusion there, Luther. Did you do an aimed burst shot?
It says like a double shot. Does that count as a burst shot?
Yeah, a double shot counts as a burst shot. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So I'll give you a choice. We can keep your roll, your aimed shot, and just re-roll damage for a single shot, or you can say, no, I really wanted to do a double shot and roll again, but you won't be able to do an aimed or called shot. It'll just hit his main body. Make sense?
Oh, okay. Yeah. I'll do the 3d6 then.
Okay, yeah. So go ahead and roll 3d6. Once again, especially for those of you who are listening or saying, no, Inferno, you're getting this Ultimate Edition thing wrong, but I'm referring to it right now, and that is my understanding. I can make adjustments, but it sounds pretty fair. Typically, anything that's more than, you know, one shot in a row is technically a burst. You know, a lot of laser weapons have a 3-shot burst. It sounds like this one has a double-shot burst. So we have to kind of use the burst rules. And for mine, what I know in Rifts, bursts can never be aimed and called, right? Bursts are just, you spew it out and you do a lot of damage to the person. So, okay, so 12 MDC to the head. Let me write that down. That's really good. So, Luther... a green beam of laser energy shoots from your rifle, hits him square in the side of the head, right behind the cheek, causing this really deep and black pit of a scar as the roars from like a small annoying, like, oh, this really hurts, to an actual pained roar bellows out from Thunk. So good job, 12 to the head. Matt.
Matt has to take an action to pull out his Wilkes pistol.
Yes. Okay. All right. So you take an action to take out your Wilkes pistol. We'll get to you real quick. Slicks.
All right. Slicks is in the ATV under the passenger seat. He looks behind him. He sees a screaming Thunk.
Yes.
He sighs, he pulls his rifle up and opens up the door. That's probably my action.
Yep, that's your action. Bingo. Thunk gives one last, I hate stupids, as he turns invisible. Victoria. Victoria? Can you hear me? Can anyone hear me?
I can hear you.
Okay,
I'm
good.
Sorry,
I have Discord paranoia now.
Yeah, it's fine. Yeah. So she'll probably wake up with a start.
Yes.
Hear the screaming.
Uh-huh.
Look back. Uh-huh. See the thunk. See her window's broken. Damn it.
Yeah.
Damn it. Grab her rifle, sitting right next to her. She was kind of paranoid.
Uh-huh.
I'll see Thunk back again there, out there. Probably, he's probably going to shoot up the car. That's likely. And so she opens up the door.
Okay, so you open up. Okay, so you grab your rifle, opens up the door, so you don't shoot through your own vehicle. Okay, good call.
Yeah,
Evan.
There's people in there still.
I pull out my L20 and get to a position where I can see the clearing.
Okay, all right. Well, I'll give you two actions in order to do that. That way, you can move a good, 15, 20 feet away from the vehicle, so it's you have a more of a clear shot. Does that sound fair?
Yep.
Perfect. Chance.
So last thing I saw was Thug turn invisible right out the back window.
Yes, he was by the back window ATV. Yeah,
I'm sitting seat of the ATV. Do I have like clear line of sight straight back?
You have a clear line of sight straight back, yes. But the problem is you don't see a Thunk anymore. You just see a somewhat broken window with the word stew etched into it.
Are any of my teammates, like, on that side of the window? Like, if I were to shoot straight out the back ATV?
No. Okay. Luther, the angles are Luther's, no. No one's directly behind. So if you shot where you last saw Thunk, you wouldn't hit your friends if it went through.
Dude, I'll just pull the trigger twice, shoot two shots right out the back of the ATV.
Okay. Now, do you have a special, when you say shoot two shots, do you mean a burst shot?
Can I just take two actions? It doesn't have a burst shot. I just want to use two actions straight off the bat to just cheat.
I appreciate the question, but I think it's best to do one attack per action, just because I don't know if you'd be crazy about me, queuing up three different punches at you. You know what I mean? So I think we'll do like one attack or one general. Some actions take a little bit longer to do, but we'll just do one attack at a time if that's okay.
Good.
Okay. So go ahead and do your first attack, first shot. Pow.
Awful.
Okay, you miss, but that's okay. You also miss the ATV, so you don't do any additional damage to it. That's okay. Luther, you hit Thunk square in the side of the head, but it's very, very dark. There is some light from your new companions, for lack of a better word. Not companions. Yip and his friends. There's some light coming from their headlights, etc. As lights are turned on, and all that good stuff. But, what are we plooping about? Oh, okay. But you can't see Thunk right now. It is dark, and he went invisible again. He cloaked himself.
All right. But I still have a general idea of where he is.
A general idea. You can make wild shots, for lack of a better word. Unless you get some sort of clue of his exact location, you know?
I'm gonna hold my action, wait and see if somebody else can hit him.
Okay, alright. No problem. We'll hold it until we get back to you, and then that action's wasted. Matt.
Alright.
Could I also hold my action?
Yep, of course. Of course you may. Slicks.
Can I be heard?
Yep, now I can hear you.
Alright, can I use my identify scent to smell this thing?
Yeah, you better believe it. Roll it. You could definitely, because Luther drew blood, you'll be able to smell his blood at least, in addition to maybe a few other things. You succeed by 20. Right? Yeah. The way you guys roll it, you've learned it from the old group. It always throws me off. I'm so used to just rolling the D100 and seeing the result and comparing it. But the minus thing always throws me off. So to confirm, Scarlet Ranger, Slicks. Sorry, Scarlet. Slicks, you succeeded by 20, right?
Yep.
Okay, great. First of all, great job. You are able to smell fresh blood that doesn't smell like human blood. It definitely has that kind of like supernatural grease to it. That kind of timber taste of blood. And you can smell it close to the driver's side door of the ATV.
Like a pointer dog, I point at the driver's side door and get ready to shoot.
Okay, great. So I'm going to let you go ahead and do a shot first, and then Luther and Matt, since you held your actions, I'll let you act, and then we'll move on to Thunk. Sound good?
Okay.
All right. So, Slicks, you are within 50 feet, so I'm going to say that's a hit. Now, Thunk wasn't expecting to be found out, so he's not going to make a defensive roll. So you do 9 mega damage to him, okay, to his main body. Okay, so just Luther and Matt, you both said you wanted to wait to see if someone else shot. Well, Slicks seemed to got a bead because the... What did you fire with, Slicks? Your laser...
NG rifle.
Your NG rifle. So you saw a red beam of light flash by the driver's side door, just outside the driver's side door, and strike something. It didn't continue onward. So, Luther, since you had the higher initiative, I'll let you act first and then go to Matt.
I would actually like for Matt to go first, okay. So to see if it'll break the guy's invincibility getting hit again.
Okay.
Maybe.
Yeah, Matt.
Because I want to shoot him in the head.
I admire your enthusiasm.
Just hate this guy's head.
Yeah, well, it's a stupid head.
Matt will just fire in that direction, then hope he doesn't hit anything he doesn't want to.
All right. Roll it. Oh, use your action here, too.
It's fine. Nice.
Oh my goodness, you just got it.
What?
Right? 5 or higher? Is that still the Ultimate Edition, or is that Old School Edition? Let me check.
I think it's 5, but...
It is 5.
It might be natural 5.
Oh, you're right. It might be a natural 5. Let me
check the rules.
Yeah. Uh-oh. Sorry, everyone. This happens from time to time when you're adjusting from one rule set to another.
Right.
No, I don't care about missile terms. What range combat?
Okay.
Here we go. Shooting blind. What you cannot see. Well, that's been targeted, so I'm not going to do that. Simultaneous. Okay, single shot penalties. Quick reference. All ranged attacks require a roll of 8 to strike.
8.
So, womp womp. Okay, that but you know what? Okay, you know what? But that's not fair because I made... Oh, no, never mind. The 9 was enough for both of the other ones. So, unfortunately, you miss, cool. Matthew. You miss, but 50-50 chance it doesn't hit the vehicle. 1d100, if it rolls lower than 50, it misses the vehicle. If it's higher, it hits your vehicle. Roll!
Nah.
Faster! Okay, roll damage.
No.
Alright, you're paying.
I will convince you that just let this go.
Alright, your ATV takes 3 points of damage there, Victoria. Big sigh. Alright.
We're trying to save your life.
Luther! Still invisible, but you have a good idea, so I'm not giving you the minus 10. Hey, LMAO, roll damage. Wait, what kind of attack did you do?
That's just, like, wild shot, I guess.
Okay, alright. Great.
Like, my WP doesn't give me any bonus at level 1, so.
Oh, perfect. Okay, yeah, so alright, great. Go ahead and roll damage. 9.
A bit less.
Alright.
But all okay.
Right. Thunk. Okay, so I'm not going to have you roll scent each time, Slicks. Like, you just have a bead on them, and it's just that, it's just period. That. Okay.
Well, actually, I do have a skill for keeping it as a bead on that's called tracking by scent.
Okay. That might come into effect, but in this very combat area, we'll just... I'm going to give you a kind of little pass right now. If you have to track them, which actually might happen, because... You can sense that Thunk is moving very rapidly away from the campsites up towards the north. He seems to be running at a high speed, and you guys can actually kind of hear the heavy footsteps as it hits the grassy earth as he begins to kind of... You don't know if he's fleeing. You don't know if he's repositioning himself. Slicks, all you can tell is that he's about now 120 feet north of your position, outside of the ATV and anyone else, right? Any sort of collateral damage.
All right, I'll let you know what I'm doing when I get to my action.
Your turn? Okay, so Victoria, would you like to do anything?
Oh, I'm just going to hold my action. Okay. She'll have her gun pointed out.
All right.
Trying to see if she can get a targeting on this. Like, if someone else hits him, then she'll probably fire at the same position.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Right now, you just see a bunch of darkness and confusion and a few shouts from Yip's companions, etc. But no bead on a target just yet. Evan.
I'm going to try and wild burst shot him. Spray and fry.
Okay. Now, since he's moved position, you don't know exactly where he is. I am going to use the shooting blind rules, right? A minus 10 to strike what you cannot see, all right? But that's just, what's your bonus to hit?
Your bonus to hit is a plus 4.
Okay, so roll a 1d20 minus 6 and get over an 8. And you'll hit him.
8.
Okay, congratulations. Roll damage. That was a wild shot. A shot in the dark. Literally a shot in the dark. All right. Don't patronize me. You can't. By the way, you can't patronize me. I'm joking. This is all part of the ribbit. Okay. Also, by the way, Evan, excellent job. All right. So that's your attack. A chance. And sorry, Victoria, I will get to you because now you can see him being hit at least. And you can... take a shot if you want. But I'm going to give chance first.
We're just going to wait.
Okay.
Like, all that just happened outside my window.
Yeah, it really did.
Yeah, I'm just going to sit here and try to digest that.
Okay, I'm going to just let you digest. Turn to digest. Okay, Victoria, you saw some wild shots being fired by Evan out into the darkness. And you see a couple land on this invisible creature. And so in that way, you can kind of get, you can shoot right where you see it. So in this moment, you won't get the minus 10 to strike.
All right, I'm going to go shoot a burst with my L20 rifle.
Okay.
So just make 20. Okay, that's an 18.
Okay, that's excellent. I'm just trying... Okay, off the top of your head, how much does a burst...
66.
No, oh, no, I'm just mean how many actions does a burst take?
No, just one.
It is just one, okay. Great.
Yep.
Okay. Roll damage.
19, main body.
Okay. When we get to the top of the turn, everyone who's looking at this wild shot can see Thunk rematerialize. He has several deep scorch marks in his back and the side of his very proud, broad chest, and he is looking wounded. I'll wait till his turn for his actions, but now his invisibility is gone due to his wounded state. So, Luther, all right. Top of the action is to you.
Going for the hit.
Okay. What kind of hit?
Going for the head.
Sorry, I thought you said going for the hit. Head. Okay, so yeah, you know how it is. Aim shot. Minus 6, so...
Oof.
Yeah. He needed to go over 12, so that's it. But that's enough to hit his main body, so go ahead and roll damage to hit his main body. 11. Nice. Okay. Another shot of laser hits him right in the small of the back, causing another roar of stupefied and confused pain. Matt.
Matt is going to try and shoot him as well.
Okay, great. That's a hit. Roll damage.
3.
Okay, well, it's better than 0. Every little bit counts.
Chip damage for the win.
I'll chip you away, Slicks.
Single damage, not damage. All
right. Can I be heard?
Yeah, we can.
Yes.
All
right, I am going to go to the nearest tree and climb it.
Okay, Slicks. You are in a grove, so there are some trees. We're going to say it takes 2 actions. One to move. What's your speed value?
34.
Oh goodness. Yeah. Okay. Definitely just 2 actions then. One to move, because there is a tree within 30 feet of you, right? A small poplar, but it's enough to hold your weight. So, one to get to it, one to climb it. Go ahead and roll me a climb check, please. Climb skill check.
Climb skill check.
Oh my goodness, and you're able to scramble it up effortlessly, reaching the third set of branches up above. Okie dokie. All right. I'm assuming you guys can hear me still, yes?
Yep.
Okay, good. I know, Scarlett, you're kind of muting yourself to prevent the echo. So, first of all, thank you. Second of all, no hard feelings if I don't hear a response from you or anything like that. Just let me know if I skip over anything. Okay, so now Thunk, regretting his intimidation attacks and all the choices he made up in life up to this point, brings a metallic, his bionic arm up in the air, and he turns towards the folks who are shooting you, and he says, and he like powers down his ionic cannon, and he says, "Okay, no more joke, done, get point, no more hunt, continue on. Friends, vouch," as he points towards Yip and his companions. Yip and the partial conversion Borg and the two highwayman companions with you all kind of with their own weapons in hand, but not point towards the party or point at towards Thunk, kind of look carefully at each other, and finally, Yip points out and they say, and he says, "Sorry, Thunk, you kind of brought it on yourself," as he looks towards Chance, Evan, Victoria, Slicks, Matt, and Luther, and he says, "You know what? He's been bothering you, and I want ourselves to have not much of an issue in the future. Whatever you do with them, it's up to you. We'll back your play." When he hears this kind of betrayal, Thunk screams, "You most stupid! I blast you all if you fight me! I kill! I fight to death!" So, it's up to you guys what you want to do with Thunk.
Shoot again.
Okay, we're okay, just shooting. Okay, all right. So Thunk, the answer is going to come first from Victoria, since it's her action next.
All right, he's visible. That's nice. Let's do another burst, see if I hit. Nope. Uh-uh. Okay, then.
That's your action.
I'm shooting out the door.
Okay. Evan.
I'm bursting.
Okay, that's a hit.
Nice.
Oh my
nice.
Goodness, very Ow. Nice. Several shots scatter amongst Thunk's already pockmarked body, causing him to kind of double over in pain. He is in not good condition now. Good shot, Evan. Crap, did I use your action yet? I don't think I did. Okay, Chance.
I is Thunk.
You is Thunk? I is Thunk.
No. What's the distance between us?
Oh, what's the distance? He's a good 110 feet away from you.
So that's not too far then. So I'll need to use an action to get out of the vehicle.
Okay. You know what? I'll give you another action to do something else, too, rather than just moving.
I'll shoot him.
Okay, yeah. Okay, shoot him.
At least attempt to.
Womp womp. Womp womp. But luckily, in my campaign, your gun doesn't jam or anything. You just miss.
Combat thing.
Okay, Luther.
Okay, so I'm pretty sure I only have one action left, because that last one was an aim shot.
Oh, it was. Okay, thank you for your honesty. I appreciate that, Luther. Okay.
But could I use the first action of the next round to take another aim shot? I really want to hit this guy in the head again.
You know what? I will allow it, because you really want to hit him in the head. And the rule of fun is I know how to deal with it, so okay. So I'm going to X this and put a T on this one to remind myself that we've used your first action. And okay. You get a 24. All right, roll damage.
Ooh.
Well, Thunk will not be thinking anymore. Thunk will not
I'm
be
shoot
doing
him between the eyes again.
Anything anymore, because right in that little bump in the bridge of his nose in between his eyes, that little goose egg that was made by that silver weapon has now been obliterated by a laser weapon, as a very nice, neat hole has been carved right in between Thunk's head, with a final twitch of his giant, toothy maw and almost complete surprise of how quickly everything turned against him. The Broadkill falls to the ground unceremoniously, crumples, so to speak.
I'm going to double tap?
If you want to, sure. You can do a confirmation kill. You can do a confirmation shot, and I won't even have you roll for it, because it's a dead body. You can hit it pretty easily. Just make sure to mark off the ammo.
Yep.
Moments after, well, give me a moment, I gotta get the other token out. Moments after Thunk hits the ground, the other humanoid, not the one who approached Victoria, but the one who's been the most quiet out of the group, immediately heads towards Thunk, almost sprints towards it with a vibro knife in his hand. And
I'm going to shout at him, "You stop."
and he stops for a moment, and he turns.
That's mine.
And he says coolly towards you, but with the vibroblade in his hand, he says, "You don't need all of them. And besides, he was traveling with us for a long, long time, long before you. How about
we?" I didn't see you shoot him.
No, but I also saw us gave you permission to shoot him.
We were shooting him before you gave us permission. We don't need your permission.
Really? This is how you're going to do the relationship? He has some great cyberware with him. How about I'll give you the choice. You take the arm or the leg, and I'll take whatever's left.
If I may interject, gentlemen. Sir, are you a doctor or a cyberdoc of any sort?
No, I just cut where it's mushy and let the cyberdocs worry about it.
Great. So you're not qualified for that. Fortunately, I am. So in order to ensure the most value is kept in all of his parts, I should probably take care of the operation.
Pauses for a moment, looks at you skeptically, and then twirls his vibroblade a few times before holstering or sliding it back into its sheath. And he says, "All right, that sounds fair. Tell you what, Doc, you carve him up for parts, and then you guys join us in our camp, and we'll negotiate terms for Thunk's pathetic corpse."
You have a bounty on him or something?
He gives a wry smile, and he goes, "Maybe. We can discuss that, too."
Well, that sounds most appropriate, right, guys? Right?
Yeah, yes. Matt. Go get the cyber war.
Great! Where'd I put my shit?
Well, I know. I know, Slicks. You come down the tree. Okay. So, Mr. Matthew Miller. I think we need a skill check from you. So, do you have... You obviously don't have an operating table, but...
I do not.
But you do have the proper medical supplies in which to excise bionics, correct?
Yes.
Good. So, then there won't be... It's a little dim, but I think we can arrange for the high beams of one of the vehicles to assist you in your surgery, yes? So with light and tools, I don't see, and because he's dead, so you don't have to worry about killing him, I don't think there should be any penalty to your skill check. So Yay. Go ahead and just roll it.
Would it be medical doctor or just cybernetic medicine?
Cybernetic medicine.
Okay.
Okay. Excellent work, Captain Miller. Excellent work.
Corporal.
Sorry, Corporal? Did I say Captain?
You've been saying Captain, but hey,
I know. I'm sorry. The C threw me off, and I'm thinking in my head my NPC. Captain Joyce Long, Corporal Miller. It makes more sense that you're a corporal. Why would you be a captain so soon? Hey,
it's fine. Matt felt very good being called Captain by accident.
By accident purpose. Okay. So, Corporal Matthew Miller and Corporal Evan Lucas, but anyway.
I mean, we can take a promotion if you
no,
want.
No,
yeah,
please
I mean,
don't read into
promotion.
Listen, the last time I misspoke, we spawned Tiny Wrath, so we don't need those consequences. But, anyway... the surgery goes absolutely without a hitch, and due to the damage being on the main body and the head of Thunk, it also doesn't have any sort of damage to it at all. It is in very, very good pre-owned condition. So you have one bionic arm with ionic weapon attachment. And one bionic leg. In addition, you also notice in your surgeries, thanks to your excellent skill, that he also has a pair of cybernetic lungs, and you're able to excise them as well. Nice. So you get bonus. Hey. Bonus hey. Goods.
Just pocket that. Mm-hmm. No.
Well, you can't pocket a pair of lungs. Anyway. No. So
I can.
This takes you about 40 minutes to do. Heads up. All right? So while you're doing so, would the rest of the party be willing to kind of do a role play with Yip and his companions over equal share of Thunk's now corpse?
Well, that would be fine.
Okay.
Sure.
Great.
Gonna make sure everybody puts their armor on first.
Sure, yeah. sure. And they do, Yip and his companions do the same. They keep their weapons ready just in case. But Yip decides to be the spokesman since he's kind of smoothed things out so far. Also, Thunk, I can just delete you from this thing right now. Also, we'll delete... It's still here. The stew is still on your vehicle, Victoria. I'm sorry, but we'll just remove it from the whiteboard.
Someone's got to pay for that.
That's true. Someone's gonna. Well, I'll leave it amongst you. So, I'm obsessively trying. There we go. I was just trying to delete that. So, Yip, being the spokesperson, gestures you over to the small makeshift campfire that their camp kind of set up, and he takes out a small brown bottle of high proof of an alcoholic beverage. He takes a swig and he passes amongst his friends, and then that bottle moves to the party. Yip says, "We find that whenever we deal with carving up who gets what, it's good that everyone gets something, a taste of something lubricating, so to speak. So go ahead, dig in. Don't worry. We've been drinking it for the past... what is it?" And then the gentleman whose voice is like leaves in fall says, 3 months.
Sorry, I like to be even-minded when I make a deal, as I can just pass it along without taking it.
Yip, shrug, suit yourself.
Slix also passes along. Mm-hmm. They won't give an answer unless asked.
Okay.
Yeah, Luther's not touching it.
Okay.
He is not happy.
Fair enough. I am grumpy, Luther.
He hasn't had his beauty sleep yet.
All right. How about Chance?
Get your drink.
You do? Uh-oh.
Like, I'll sniff it first, but sure. Then, yeah, I'll take a hard
it
drink.
It smells like super, super... high proof whiskey. Super strong.
Yeah, I'll
okay.
Take a full shot.
Okay, all right. Anyone else taking a drink before the conversation broaches?
Victoria, well, in order to make sure at least someone drinks a bit more in order to make them feel a bit more at ease, we'll take a small sip of it, cough, and just give it back.
Okay. So, Slix gives a kind of a blunted tooth smile. He says, "Okay, I've been thinking about this. How about we keep it real simple, all right? You keep all the hardware you took off of Thunk, all right? You let us keep the head, and we'll get the money for the bounty."
Just came right out with that.
Yeah. How much is the bounty, perchance?
Oh, says Yip. Not nearly as much as you would get selling those to a reputable body chop shop.
Should I roll interrogation to find out if he's lying?
Yes. Yes, you can. Just waiting for the roll.
Damn it. Failed by three.
Does anyone have... Unfortunately, Corporal Miller is still doing his thing, so he wouldn't be able to appraise the items just yet.
I have appraise goods.
Oh, you do?
Goods, but no specialty for...
For bionics. Cyberware?
Oh, yeah. Okay. No specialties either.
Yeah, there's no specialty. So you guys can do it, but you would need to succeed by a significant amount.
All right.
Might as well roll them bones.
All right, got the high roll out.
You got the high roll super out.
That's my job here, getting the high rolls out. Damn it, Slicks.
No luck for Slicks, too. So you're not too sure.
Let's see. Anything else can help.
Well, I at least don't trust him on principles, but
yeah. Well, that's probably a good call.
Got barter.
Barter, okay.
Yeah, I have that too.
Alright. Barter could be good with negotiating specific prices, right? And Yip will continue. He'll say, let's just say it's gonna be enough for us to pad our life in Tolkeen a little bit and perhaps pay off someone else's bounty, as he looks towards the fellow who first came at Thunk's corpse with the vibroblade.
Thank you for informing me he has a bounty as well.
Yeah, but it's just a misunderstanding, you see, with the authorities. Nothing nearly as cruel or sadistic as Thunk. Petty larceny, you know, theft of cybernetic goods, nothing major. Nothing to get in your nothing to get us all in knots about. It gives him a chance for a fresh start. Come on, we have ourselves a great business arrangement, fame and fortune and stuff like that. We don't want to blow that up, right? You guys got your revenge for Thunk being, well, Thunk, right? You get yourself a nice payday with your cyber gear. We get to clear, you know, our friend's name, and we get to continue on as per usual. It's a win-win situation.
Out of character, how much is he offering us?
All the cyberware. That was in him.
Out of character, guys, our goal is simply to infiltrate and get what we needed. Any extra dough is extra dough.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Besides, the cyberware could possibly be traded to the black market in order to get us in if necessary.
Oh.
Or both bounties could also be traded in to get us into the city.
That is true as well.
This is also true.
Or... the final thing, which is what I'm thinking, bandits have a sizable amount of information.
Mm-hmm. Yes, this is true.
All of this appears to be quite true.
The question is you as a party, what route do you want to go down?
Well, out of character, do you guys want to go in the front gates, or do you want to go through the black market?
I think black market would open up more opportunities.
Who's taking out the bounty on them? Is it the city or is it the black market?
You don't know. Yeah. You can ask.
Yeah, as part of if we agree to this, we can ask for okay, who's the bounty on? Like, where it's from?
Oh, you do ask that?
No, this is out of character. Okay. Just giving a suggestion.
Okay, we're gonna ask where the bounty's from.
Yeah, ask him where the bounty's from. But, like, not me, because I'm not talking to this guy.
Alright, I got it. Okay. Alright, guys, I see where you're coming from. Who placed the bounty on you? The city?
Yeah. As Yip looks over towards his companion. The Tolkien authorities. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, see, he was charged with cyber theft, and he kind of didn't show up and escape, so they put a bounty on his head. So it's nothing major, right? And it's not a dead or alive bounty. It's a capture bounty. So
of course.
Yeah, of course. So it's nothing too high. It's only 20,000 credits.
So if you guys have bounties from the city, you know anything about the shadier parts of that city? You know, possibly additional ways in?
The fellow,
maybe a place to sell things?
The fellow with the vibroblade, whose bounty everyone is discussing, perks up, and he says, yeah, after all, if I'm a cyber snatcher with a bounty on my head, what kind of cyber snatcher would I be if I didn't know who to sell to, who the good contacts were, what the underbelly of Tolkeen was like? I'll tell you this now for free. It's fresh pickings. It's never been independent operators everywhere. Years ago, there was a really organized criminal force, but that's kind of melted away. I hear they're trying to claw back. I hear rumors. I know certain contacts, but it's like a criminal Wild West out there. It's difficult, it's well organized, and magicians are annoying as hell, but I could make some introductions.
Yeah, I personally believe introductions are more valuable than whatever that head has on it.
Okay. All right.
This is a fair arrangement.
I agree. He says, a very fair arrangement. Clearing my name and making some introductions. No skin off my nose. Plus, it prevents a unnecessary showdown. A second one that we've avoided. Yeah, I can deal with that. And everyone nods their heads eagerly. The partial conversion Borg, and you know all the other gentlemen, and Yip, of course.
Great. Then we have a deal.
We have a deal. And with a shake of the head, another swig, they say, well, we got at least a few hours rest, and now with Thunk out of the way, I reckon it will be a peaceful sleep. We'll see you in the morning.
Yep.
Great.
In the morning.
Great. Matthew, you managed to finish your removal of the cybernetic components. And eventually, once he makes sure it's completely clear, the head is severed from Thunk's shoulders as the rest of his body is just left to rot on the side of the grove. And with that, if you guys are comfortable, if you guys want to do some in-character discussion as you guys bed down for the rest of the night, but spoiler alert, there's going to be no additional concerns or anything like that. And we'll get right into the morning and back on your way.
All right. Just because this is Slicks, he would suggest burying Thonk's body once we're done with it so no other predators come along.
That would be smart.
Okay. Who wants to volunteer on digging duty?
Slicks offered.
Mm-hmm. I'll give Slicks a hand.
Okay.
Luther will help. He helped make the body.
I help make the body. I help bury the body. Friends do. All right. Between the three of you, you're able to dig a Thunk-sized hole and put a Thunk inside that hole and bury that Thunk-sized hole. And due to your wilderness knowledge, group wilderness knowledge in regards to this, you're able to, you know, get it deep enough where no predators can easily dig it up, but not so deep that you're there all night. So between the three of you, I'd say about 40 to 50 minutes, he is properly buried in the earth, the rest of his Thunky remains. Okie dokie?
Yep.
Good. Now, soon, a few hours later, the sharp orange light of dawn begins to pierce through the horizon as Yip and his companions begin to rise, repack, make themselves a quick breakfast of iron rations, kind of survival rations, and some jerked meat products before putting up their gear, packing it all away into their ragtag ATV, and let you know that they are ready to depart.
Great.
So, Yip, as the spokesperson, before you get ready to, you yourselves get ready to go, we'll say, so, we're going to have to tiptoe carefully around Tolkeen because of the current bounty on Sam here, as he gestures his tongue to his head towards the gentleman with the vibra belt knife, the ones with the bounty. We're going to pretty much make our way to the closest kind of bounty office at their military checkpoint, give them Thunk's head, and immediately cash in the bounty to absolve our friend here. This will probably take a bit of time, knowing how much bureaucracy there is in Tolkeen and security checks and all that sort of thing. You guys can wait around with us if you want, or we can agree to meet you a little bit later on, either in or outside of the city. What do you think?
I think we can handle getting into the city ourselves.
Okay. And with free and clear, with Sam's name free and clear, we shouldn't have much issues getting inside the city either. So, where you want to meet up? We can give you a couple suggestions if you want.
I believe we have already set up an arrangement.
Yeah. For, the confident heart. Yeah, give me a second. I'm just trying to think days. 8 o'clock. Yeah, tomorrow. Tomorrow at, dinner time, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, well, you want to meet then? I thought maybe you would want to meet sooner, you know, because of Sam's connections and stuff, but we can meet you then.
Oh, no, guys, connections does sound valuable to get early.
Earlier,
sure. Looks just shrugs.
Okay. Well, he pauses for a moment and goes, well, tell you what, how about we stay within radio contact? How about we set up a secure radio channel just between us? And if you want to get a hold of us earlier on than our prearranged meeting, you just give us a call on the radio.
That sounds like a fine idea.
Okay. So do any of you have radio basic or radio use advanced?
Yeah, I have basic. I have electronic countermeasures.
Oh, my.
Which I believe that replaces advanced.
It does. So I think that's the most advanced out of all of them. So I guess I'll have you roll that skill.
Yeah. It's a bit lower than my radio basic, but let's hope it works.
Mm-hmm.
So. Oh! It worked!
Yeah, well, at least you got one on your end, right?
Yeah.
So our what can I do here? Okay, so this is you know, your exceptional success, all right? Not only are you able to configure a nice, secure connection between yourself and Slicks and his companion's radio, but you're also able to tinker with the radio of your traveling companions as well. In fact, so well that it is expertly and professionally encrypted. I'm talking like military-grade encryption you've managed to go in that. So as far as being infiltrating Tolkeen and communicating with each other, having concerns about someone picking up your radio signal, that chance has just plummeted to extremely, extremely low because of the work you've put in this morning. Sound fair?
Yeah. And as she finished up that, she's like, wait, this is brilliant. Pulls out a journal, a notebook, and starts madly writing down what she did.
Yeah, because you had a kind of flash of genius. You know, as you're tinkering around this, you're like, well, wait, what do I do if I do this? What if I do that? Oh, shit. oh shit, you know, type of thing. It's kind of an artistry, that the artistry blended in with your technical know-how.
Mm-hmm.
Great, 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 great.
Great job, Vic.
Mm-hmm. So she guys,
gives it a thumbs up.
Mm-hmm. So guys, I'm gonna probably wrap up this current session relatively soon. We're gonna get you to Tolkeen in the security process and get you inside the city, and then we'll wrap up your adventure, your objectives, with our next section, which will be probably a little bit longer than the current one, but because of my earlier job commitments and making me go home late and all that other stuff, is that cool? Is that all right with all you guys? You guys can still stick around for the next 20, 25 minutes, half an hour or so?
Yep.
Okay.
Sounds good to me.
Awesome, awesome, awesome. So, thanks. So, with that, you do temporarily part ways with Yippee-ki-yay, Yip and his companions, agreeing to meet you or communicate with you earlier on as you, once again, your group, your two hover cycles and the ATV, make your way to Tolkeen itself, in which I am going to kind of zip you on over to the free city of Tolkeen. You may have seen this before, but you're seeing it again. So, the free city of Tolkeen is a kind of glimmering, towering jewel. For those of you who have spent most of your lives with the Coalition or in the Coalition employ, it is a very bizarre and perhaps even disturbing sight. Instead of bastions and towers and fortifications of great mega damage, you know, fortified buildings, it's these strange stone towers, this medieval look that reeks of magic and techno-wizardry and other such dabblings and forces that are beyond human understanding and human morality. Regardless, you must morally pinch your noses, if you choose to as you come closer and closer towards the city, as you get funneled and funneled in towards certain security checkpoints. The first perimeter security checkpoints are very, very basic that we don't really need to roleplay. Just to, you know, where you came from, do you have any weapons, do you have any contraband, a quick look over, etc., right? It is when you reach the vehicle docking, well, docking, that sounds like a spaceship, but vehicular parking, and unloading, and the actual checkpoints to get into Tolkeen itself is when things get a little bit more rigorous. So before I kind of get you all through the security process, your own kind of individual interactions with security personnel, right? I want to give you guys a moment because you'd be taking about another hour or two to journey there and kind of get your story straight. How do you guys want to present yourselves at the gates of Tolkeen, so to speak?
If you're a talent agency, actually
introduce the group, because I can speak Dragonese, and it doesn't really look like Coalition if someone's speaking Dragonese.
That's true. That's true.
Talent scout business cards.
Talent scout slash merc.
We're bodyguards for Chance.
Yeah.
If we want to look even more presentable, I could use wardrobe and grooming to give everyone a boost.
Hmm.
And we're from
nice.
Right?
Ishpeming, yep.
Yep. Ishpeming.
Just remember that I'm a feral mutant. Just so, because they have CS armor, just say I'm a feral mutant.
Alright.
Alright then. Perfect. It sounds like you guys are pretty confident, so I can go ahead. Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Yep. Cool.
Sounds all right.
So you are guided by friendly but firm security personnel to park your vehicles in large possible parking spaces. Previously, for those of you who ever ventured or rumored of Tolkeen, typically what would happen is that you would be offered a locker to store some of your high technological goods, aka your MDC weapons and armor, etc., while you're visiting the city of Tolkeen. And there were a lot of independent operators, independent individuals, businesses who would rent out their own lockers. Sometimes street rats, street kids would come in and bother to offer to guard your vehicle for you, for example, or individual security. Things have changed in Tolkeen slightly. Things have clamped down. And this is now from the security lockers to offering to guard an individual's possessions is now completely in the realm of the Tolkeen government and Tolkeen sanctioned security forces. So this is another bit of evidence that things have kind of firmed up a little bit in the free city of Tolkeen. And their rates are standardized. If you want someone to guard your vehicle, it will be 50 credits a day. If you're looking to store, you must store your weapons either inside of your vehicle or in a locker. And those lockers can provide a 5 foot cubed space for 200 credits a day, or double that for 500 credits a day. So the question will be, for all your mega damage weapons and armor and vehicles, what do you want your storage options to be? And I'll write them down so you don't have to memorize how much credits this is going to cost.
Is this individual or the group?
This is individually.
All right, Styx is going to have to ask someone to spare him. He only has 50 credits.
Poor
I'll spare Styx.
Oh, man.
Yeah. I'll buy me and Slix accommodations.
Yeah, they don't trust rats with money.
Okay, I'll buy for the AP. Oh, God. Now I can't remember what's called. Big Boss, I'll buy for that. And since it's spacious, we can store stuff inside of it without having to use a locker.
Put my ion blaster in the ATV, then.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. All right. It sounds like everyone's pretty much fine with storing their goods in the ATV, and you do have enough space for it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So you're going with the cheapest option. Now, are you going to have anyone guard the ATV?
Yes.
Okay. Great.
It'd be unwise not to.
Okay. It would be risky not to. I agree. So it's, as I mentioned, it's going to be 50 credits a day. I'll just keep track of how many days you're there, and you'll pay it out by the time you leave. Sound good?
Yeah, we can go 10 credits each for every 50.
Yeah.
Except for Slix, I'll just pay for him because he's a rat.
Because he's a poor street rat, perhaps? Yep. I don't buy that. All right, anyway. Okay.
Do we need to get protection for our hover cycles too?
Well, that's up to you.
Do you all think that'd be a good idea, or?
The security personnel would recommend it.
I suppose I'll get it too.
Okay. All right. I will jot that down. All right. That's right, Victoria. Okay, so with that, you make arrangements with the security personnel to guard your vehicle. As you make your way up, guarded again by security folks, over towards a variety of checkpoints. I'll let the person who wants to speak for the group lead, so to speak. And you soon come across a collection of security personnel. You recognize, of course, that two of them are Psy Stalkers, expert human mutants that are great at ferreting out psychic and magical energy and powers. You also see a few other more mundane personnel. And at the front, the individual who's asking most of the questions behind this kind of sleek metallic desk is a fellow. He looks relatively old. He's approximately maybe 65, maybe even pushing towards 70s. Thinning gray hair, kind of a gaunt face with a lot of wrinkles in it. But despite his more slightly advanced age, he seems to be in pretty good shape. He has this kind of white goatee on his face, and he is checking things off, interestingly enough, and kind of primitively enough, not on any sort of terminal or electronic communication, but instead kind of a larger ledger that appears to be inked with a flowing kind of fountain-like pen as he starts to write down particular details. As your group approaches, with a thin, welcoming smile, he says, "Hello and welcome to the free city of Tolkeen. Before we can let you through, I want to ask you a few questions. I advise you to answer as openly and honestly as possible. Are you ready?"
"Of course, we got nothing to hide."
"Excellent. So what is the purpose of your visit here today?"
"Well, Chance, do you want to take this?"
Forward, pull out a business card. "Chance Masterson, Talent Scout out of Ishpeming. These gentlemen and fine lady are my entourage. We're here to hopefully set up some new connections with local content producers."
"I see. Business. I see. Do any of you have residents here in the free city of Tolkeen, or are citizens of our fair city?"
"Not yet."
"I see."
"Yeah, not yet. That's a good answer."
"Are you citizens of any of the baronies in the region?"
"We're over from Ipswich."
I see. Are you currently under any sort of mercenary contracts, perhaps out of Ishpeming with the Northern Gun or with other governmental bodies?"
"Only people hiring us is Chance with his talent agency."
"I see. And smile. What kind of talent do you procure, Mr. Masterson?"
"Oh, talents of all kinds. Voice talent, screen talent, writing talent, street performers, magicians. If we can sell tickets to it, we want to set them up where they can make the best money."
"I understand. Well, he pauses for a moment.
And be as trustworthy, appear as trustworthy as possible. So if I can, I'd like to use my trust skill."
"Yeah, please do. Please do. Please do. It'll be very useful."
"Natural 100, we all get thrown in jail."
"Don't say such things."
"Oh." He takes a look at your card, puts it in between his fingers, copies down some of the information, returns it with a smile. "I see. Now, Mr. Masterson, I'd just like to ask a few questions of your entourage. I'm sure as leader of this little organization of yours, you're used to taking the lead, but it's not just you who will be entering our fair city."
"Of course, of course."
"Of course." His eyes go over towards Victoria.
"The card. I want him to keep the card."
And he says, "Oh, that won't be necessary, sir. I've jotted down everything. And I'm in the security business."
"I won't push it."
"Good call." The fellow gives a thin smile towards Victoria, and he says, "Your name, ma'am?"
"And she'll say in Dragonese, Victoria Siri."
He'll reply in Dragonese. "Ah, and the rest of this conversation is going to be in Dragonese, but he seems very responsive." He asks, "I see. And how long have you been employed with Mr. Masterson?"
"About a few months now."
"I see. Do you have any extra ordinary skills. Can you cast magic, or do you have psionic powers?
I unfortunately cannot. While I have studied magic, in the academic sense, I have not been able to practice it.
Oh, in the academic sense. He asks, have you ever enrolled in the Tolkeen University?
Tolkeen, sadly, no. I have studied out of the new Laszlo Library, but no formal education.
New Laszlo, at the sound of that, he gives a bit of a smile. Understanding. Interesting, interesting. And where did you pick up Dragonese?
There as well. Self-taught.
Self-taught. He says, that, and then he would say in Dragonese, that explains your rough accent. Like someone who studied it out of books. Like someone who studied it secondhand rather than from a trusted instructor. And then he moves on to Corporal Miller. And he says now in American, and your name, sir?
Matthew Miller, sir.
Matthew Miller. And how long have you been employed with Mr. Masterson?
A few months.
I see, a few months. And what's your role with him?
Well, I, along with my medical talents, do sing sometimes for him.
Sing?
Yes, sir.
Oh, can you sing something now?
A little on the spot, don't you think, sir?
Yes, but it's the best way to figure out your credentials are true. If you say you're a singer, I'd like to hear you sing.
Sure, sir.
You don't have to actually sing in character. Do you have the skill?
I have the skill.
Roll it. Sing for your entrance.
This is the worst episode of a Coalition's Got Talent ever. Getting flashbacks to all my propaganda.
You just shut him up before we start.
Wow. Well, with everyone, at least it wasn't 100.
I think it would have rather 100.
Well, I don't have those rules of you fail miraculously. I find those really tricky to do. Okay.
He's just gonna step in and be like, "You introduced yourself as Matthew Miller, is that correct? Or would you introduce yourself out of character?"
I introduced myself as Matthew Miller.
Mr. Miller hasn't done any of his warm-ups and isn't used to being put onto the spot. Usually, it takes a whole day's worth of preparation to get that angelic voice out properly.
Roll trust again.
Let's do this.
One time. The one time I fail.
Ha! 70.
One moment, please, as he gestures over towards one of the Psy Stalkers and separates Matthew Miller from the group. He says, "We just have some secondary questions to ask Mr. Miller. This fine lady will assist you there." As Matthew, you are guided away from your group.
Wait, I'm sure if you just give me another chance.
We most certainly don't. You have nothing to worry about. It's just secondary follow-up questions, he says with a reassuring smile. As he moves over towards Slicks. And I'm going to get to you in a moment, Matthew Miller, in just a moment.
Evan, you said I'd be a natural.
And then he comes across the person with the CS armor.
Okay. Yeah, he says, and your name, sir?
People call me Slicks.
I see. Slicks. And how long have you been employed with Mr. Masterson?
About a few months.
A few months as well. And have you... How did you come into employ with Mr. Masterson?
Yeah, he thinks about it for a little bit, and then he says, "Well, I guess since I'm in Tolkien, it's fine. I doubt any CS operatives are here." I was running from the CS, Feral here, and I ran into Mr. Masterson, and... He was gracious enough to give me an appointment.
I see. Would you like to give me your left arm for a moment, please, sir?
Please, sir.
He does so.
He looks, and he takes your arm, and he sees that bit of fur that was shaved off to remove your marking implant. And he says, "Ooh, that's messy work, and the wound still seems, not fully healed. Did you do this yourself?"
No. I point over to the singer, over to where he was. Uh-huh. He did it.
I see.
I see.
Are you aware of any other coalition tracking device that might be in your person?
No, but I would be gladly for you to check me over. I do not want to be caught ever.
I can understand. They're extremely cruel people to sentient beings. You have my deepest sympathies, he says with a reassuring smile. Well, you don't have to worry about that here, but I think we will take you up on that. You can never be too safe. Follow this gentleman here as he gestures over to a fellow in a cowl as he also kind of takes you off to one side. He then looks over towards Evan Lucas, and he says, "Your name, sir?"
Evan. Evan Lucas.
Evan Lucas, I see. And you are also employed with Mr. Chance Masterson?
Employed, yeah.
And what role do you fulfill? What whole role do you help him with?
He's my personal friend, and I act as a bit of a bodyguard for him, and I can scout the path ahead for him, make sure no bandits try and hop on us.
I see, very nice. And you met with him in the Manistique Imperium, right?
Over in Ishpeming.
Oh, that's right, he says, giving a knowing smile. Ishpeming, that's right.
Work, kid.
and he says, do you have any sort of affiliation contracts with any other governmental body?
No, just chance.
I see. And how long do you plan on staying here in the Free City of Tolkeen?
Well, I hope to do some sightseeing, but if Chance needs to go early, we need to go early.
I see. Well, I do recommend heading towards our biodomes and zoos. It is quite fascinating. Out of this world, so to speak. Sometimes, quite literally. He gives a bit of a chuckle. That will be all, Mr. Lucas. And finally, his eyes head towards Luther, and he says, your name, sir?
Luther. Hunter.
Luther Hunter. And do you have any particular skills to assist Mr. Masterson? Do you sing or juggle, perhaps?
I shoot things.
You shoot things. A mercenary?
Yeah.
A mercenary, I see. What was the last mercenary organization you worked for?
Can I roll, some sort of... I don't know any.
Oh, you don't know any? Okay. Just out of character, you don't know any? Okay.
I have no idea.
No, that's okay. I can tell you what. This is a kind of a free... I have established mercenary outfits, both canon and stuff that I've made up. I can give you some examples. Or there are a ton of mercenary outfits out there, dude. If you want to just come up with a cool name for a merc outfit and fit that into your backstory or even just something that you're going to make up, feel free to do so.
Yeah. Dude. Northern
guns aren't so big because we're from Ishpeming.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's probably something I would know in character.
Okay.
Northern gun is...
All right.
Because my character is from... Lone Star, so he'd probably say something from down there.
Okay, so maybe Siege Division?
Sure.
Okay.
He'd say it's Siege Division.
Oh, yes. Yes, infamous unit. Now, why did you leave their employ?
Felt I needed to change. Was getting bored.
Boredom, I see. Have you ever been approached by the coalition states in which to assist them in a military capacity?
No.
Have you been approached by the coalition states to assist in an espionage capacity?
No.
I see. Do you currently have a confidential information clause with Mr. Masterson? In other words, would some of the information that you gleaned from your business relationship with Mr. Masterson, would the information that you garnered from him, would you sell it to anybody?
Probably not. I don't think
probably not. You don't think so. I see. Is there any circumstance that you would sell personal information to a competitor?
If they threatened my life?
Coercion. Coercion. That's understandable. Yeah. That or a loved one, yes?
Yeah.
Do you have any loved ones in the area?
No.
No.
Don't have any more loved ones.
I see. He pauses for a moment. Finally, do you have any sort of extra human capabilities, whether it be psionic, magical gifts, or other supernatural capacity?
No.
No. I see. He looks at Luther for a moment, sizing you up.
Kind of like flatly stare back at him.
He purses his lips and nods. He says, understandable. Very well. If please wait here for a moment for us to finish our secondary questioning and medical examination of your companions. And you will be free to enter as a group, he says under his breath, hopefully, as we zoom the camera into poor Corporal Matthew Miller. You have been escorted to a simple, nondescript office off to the side of the security checkpoint. It is just you, a simple wooden table, a couple chairs, a single light above your head, a reflective mirror, a recording device, and a very stern-looking, bald, hairless, Psy Stalker, who says quite clearly, you suck at singing.
I'm not usually.
Uh-huh. So, why don't you tell me what you're really here about, and we can go from there.
I honestly was telling the truth the first time.
I see. A long pause as this woman wraps her fingers along the wooden desk.
I'm actually mostly just eye candy, though.
Not working, she says. The levity, the jokes, beyond that. I'm trying to assess whether you're just naive and untalented, or there's something deeper down inside.
Well, I'm talented. I can try again. I'm not usually like that.
Mm-hmm. Maybe at the end, once I've made my decision about you. Wait, out of character. You aren't psychic, right? I'm looking at your character.
No,
you're not. Psychic. Okay, not good. I wanted to make sure. I just, you know, because sometimes people update their character sheets and whatnot. So I just want to make sure. Yep. She says, well, I know one thing for sure is that you're not any sort of psychic, which wouldn't help much. Maybe a little bit. I could check you for any sort of security tags since they like to mark their property. And unfortunately, you don't have a magical ability, which would make you lower the suspicion significantly. Not ultimately, but significantly. So, tell me a little bit more in detail, if you will, about how you met your current employer, this entertainment scout. Please feel free to go into as deep a background as you need to be. As she begins to watch you intently. Out of character, take your time.
This is your test, Matt.
I hate you, Evan. You said I'd be a nasty. I'm gonna beat you up, I swear.
I'm the natural here.
Yeah. Me saying you were the natural.
You know what? You rolled the 99.
Yeah. I did roll the 99. Oh my god.
Tell you what, since I don't want to put you as a player on the spot, if you like, you can roll another D100, and we can kind of extrapolate how detailed you get into your lie. So yeah. Really, because that's kind of how RPGs go, yeah. Right? If you want to roleplay it yourself, you can. But if you don't have the capacity or comfort of roleplaying, we leave it up to some skills that you might have or a die roll. Right.
It's not that I'm not comfortable. It's that I'm still new, and I don't think I can ever come up with a convincing lie with such little information that I have.
About the world and everything like that. Okay, and that's super fair. That's super fair. So, well, how can we resolve this? Because I don't want to have just the variable, a variance of a dice to determine your fate. I don't think that's cool.
Well, so, honestly, mostly what I wanted to try was to just be as flowery as possible to try and charm her and just let me go, please.
Okay, you know what? How about we do that? You have a MA skill, mental affinity, right? And also physical beauty.
Yes.
Which one do you want to use?
Beauty, please.
Beauty? Okay, all right, that's fine. You can bat your eyelashes and say, I don't know what I'm doing. So what's the skill? What's the skill percentage? I mean, what's the number of your physical beauty?
33.
Oh, my God. Okay. So the skill check is going to be times 3. Wait, which is a 99. No, that can't be right. Holy shit, that's a high skill.
I think it maxes out at 92.
It does max out at 92. That's still super high for this particular situation. We'll have 92 be the base, but we're going to make her suspicion. Give it a penalty of 30. You know what I mean?
Okay. Ooh.
So that's a 62. So try kind of charm your way with a 62.
All right.
There you go. Nice. So this is what we're going to do. We're going to role play you because you don't know much about the background, right? So how about I help you out in regards to that? And this also might give you a better idea of, you know, how the world is, right?
Right.
Because in the world of Rifts in particular, Matt Miller, is that it's 200, 300 years after the apocalypse, right? So a lot of growth has happened, right?
Mm-hmm.
But it's still very much a very dark and dangerous place with a couple specks of light and civilization. Some of those specks are the coalition states. Some of them are free independent towns. Some of them are other governments, right? But most of the time, even small villages, small communities get overrun by 100 different things. It could be a plague from another dimension. It could be demons, monsters, bandits, etc. It's a very brutal world out there in which these areas like the Free City of Tolkeen, and even in its own way the coalition states, is trying to create some sort of order, civilization, law back the way it used to be, right? These different city states have different objectives to doing so. Tolkeen, for example, embraces and is not afraid of magic. It's coalition states is. But a believable background of how you meet someone, especially in the greater world, is either you're from a smaller community that was befallen a tragedy, or maybe not a tragedy, maybe a great boon, right? Maybe they were traveling on through and you saw an opportunity hitched with them. So saying you started from humble beginnings from a town like Fletcher or Hawk or something like that, even a made-up village back, you know, a long distance away, how are they going to check that, right? So you could say chance came through on that. You were a farmer. You were down on your luck. But you did actually have a nice voice. And so he kind of took you on. He saw your talent. And you kind of learned from him, etc. Right? The other option you could go with the description is that you were befallen by bandits or highwaymen or cyber snatchers. You know, like the individuals that you just interrupted. Or a monster. And those that you were traveling with before, you had no one else to go to, etc. Right? So we'll say for the sake of your explanation, you choose one of these backgrounds, right? They're fabrications. But what you really do is you throw in your own kind of charm, right? Your physical beauty enhances the person, you know, wanting to trust you, because it is a psychological failing of ours, is that we do equate goodness with beauty, right? We're more likely to help an attractive stranger than an unattractive stranger, right? We're more likely to believe that an attractive person is telling us the truth rather than an unattractive person. It's a mental failing in human psychology. And it's something that can be exploited even here. But you can't be super overt about it. She's too cunning, right? But you can be implicit. And perhaps your own kind of nervous, aw shucks, boyish charm is what kind of pushes the day with this story. So thanks to your skill check with that, she'll once again ask you to demonstrate your voice. I'm not going to make you roll again because I think that would be cruel, right? You're able to maybe get some more composure or at least string a couple notes together, sing whatnot. And with after a firm warning and an implicit will be watching you, she will let you go and enter the city. Sound good?
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry, that was a big blah, blah, blah on my part, but hopefully you guys didn't mind. Anyway.
It's fine.
So, Slicks, yours is much easier. They actually just give you a medical exam.
Do they find any extra chips?
No, they don't.
Checking for fleas?
They don't find any extra chips on you at all, actually. They do see remnants of previous ear tags and surgical scars from your past, you know, certain modifications.
Yep, I have lots of knife scars all over my face.
Yeah, exactly. Things like that. They give you some medical advice and treatment, but other than that, they don't find any sort of foreign bodies inside of your normal body. Okay, so reunited, both Matthew and Slicks are reunited with the rest of the group, and you are permitted entries into the Free City of Tolkeen. And to be, just to confirm, none of you have any psychic or magical powers, right?
Nope.
Correct.
And just to confirm, none of you are trying to actually sneak in a mega damage weapon, are you?
Nope.
Okay. Great. So with that, we will kind of wrap up this session right now. It was just a short little four-hour affair, but we will be continuing on with this little mini adventure and finishing off with the excursion and meeting the objective here in the Free City of Tolkeen. Super excited. A big thank you to Trav, Jason, Scarlet, Senno. I don't know what you prefer. I guess Golden Slinger and TMT Tomorrow Face. TM Tomorrow. Anyways, everyone here. Tom is fine. Okay. I want to thank you all. This was really exciting and a great first step of the mini campaigns. I look forward to finishing off this adventure and playing with these characters again in future adventures. You know, once other folks get a chance. So I'm going to wrap up the stream. Thank you so much for watching. If you have anything you want to share, feel free. I'm going to link my Discord here if you want to take part. Everyone is still free. Feel free to take part here in both the Tolkeen campaign or the Coalition campaign. It's all one big campaign. You just pick a side that you want. I'm still using the hashtag RiftyFell for all announcements, fan art that you might want to post, all that great stuff. This VOD will be on my main YouTube channel, and also, since this is the Coalition one, the special Coalition channel that I'm making as well. So I will also give links to that so you can subscribe and keep on top of that sort of goodness as well. And I might not spam my entire YouTube channel in regards to this. I think I might keep it on my YouTube channel for a while and transition it. We'll kind of see. Give me your feedback, what you'd like to see, etc. But once again, a big, big warm thank you for all the players and all of you who are watching. Looking forward. We're going to be playing with the Tolkeen group next. So not this Saturday, but the Saturday after. And see what hijinks they get into and what their objectives are. Dun, 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 dun. All right. Say goodbye, everyone.
Bye.
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 Bye.